Daytona International Speedway. This was to have been a glorious opening to a new NASCAR season. It's not. I'm Chris Economak. The deaths of racing legend Neil Bonnet and newcomer Rodney Orr during practice on the track here has stunned and saddened the racing world. But nowhere has the effect been more evident than at Thursday's pre-race drivers' meeting.
I'm tired of losing my friends and my friends getting hurt. I don't know about you guys. I hope you got a lot of consideration for other competitors instead of a lot of balls and no brains. We don't need that in this sport. I've been upside down here at Daytona. I've been upside down at Talladega. And let me tell you, it hurts, okay? These cars just don't drive down the straightaways and flip upside down by themselves. They just don't spin out by themselves. They just don't go flying through the grass by themselves. That happens because we hit people. We run into each other. I'm just as guilty of it as anybody else. I'm trying to change. Earnhardt, Ernie, myself, Kenny, all of us, we've all done it. We're trying to get it to stop. Use your head. If the car does not handle, it's not going to fix itself. Make a pit stop and work on it. Please respect each other. We can do that. There's no problem with that. Anybody that got anything else to say?
He's right. We just 18-foot car won't put in a 9-foot hole. There ain't no way to put it in there without causing a hell of a mess. And we had a reality check this week, you know, with a couple guys, and it's the first race here. We got to use our heads.
I think everybody's got more concern for this race than they've had in a long time. And I think I even go out on a limb and say that I think every damn body in this room is running a little bit scared. And I will tell you, my wife is running damn scared, and I think the rest of your wives and families are too. So use your damn heads, please.
Okay, one more. If past champions are concerned, imagine how the three rookie drivers feel. One of them, Loy Allen, sits on the pole. He's with Mike Joy now.
Yes, Chris, for the first time, they'll be following a rookie stripe to the green flag in the Daytona 500, Loy Allen's Ford Thunderbird. But in Thursday's qualifying race, Allen started on the pole, and all the veteran drivers went to the other lane and excluded him from the draft. And here we are, race morning. He's surrounded by the likes of Earnhardt, Ernie Irvin, Rusty Wallace, the hardest chargers in the sport. And so, Loy Allen, rookie sensation, how do you feel, and how will a start at today's race maybe be a little different from Thursday?
I think we learned a lot on Thursday. The Hooters team did a great job getting us prepared, and we're going to just try to run hard and try to find a place we can get in and draft and make all the laps we can and get experience for the end of the race.
Good luck today. It's 101 inside that car right this moment as Loy Allen starts his sixth ever Winston Cup race. Sharp contrast to the man next to him on the front row. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, a rookie he ain't. Six national champions and 23 races here at Daytona. What are we going to do today to get this black car in that black hole, Dale?
Well, it's a big, beautiful place to be, Victor Lane. And, two dozen may be our number. Who knows? We're going to be working hard for it and try to win the gold medal of Winston Cup racing at the Daytona 500. And, Neil, we're going to take him along in our hearts, remember him well, and the folks that's really helped us all of these years. And maybe it'll all come together today. It's just been a big week for us. Maybe we can do it today.
Well, there you have it, Ken. A thirst for victory tinged with a lot of sadness today here at Daytona.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Daytona International Speedway requests that you join us now in a moment of remembrance as the Reverend Hal Marchman offers our invocation.
Today, we want to honor the memories of four outstanding NASCAR drivers whom we have lost in the last year. Neil Bonnet was a unique person, friendly, caring, and with a contagious smile. A friend said that when two people were talking about Neil, they were always smiling. Rodney Orr, a bright, promising, ambitious young driver, came to the end of his career and life far too young. In 1993, Alan Kulwicki and Davy Allison were killed in off-track accidents. Let us pause for a moment of silence in memory of these four drivers and their families. Almighty God, we give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and for his mercy endureth forever. Help us never to get too busy, or too excited, or too worried, or too sad, or too happy, or too lowly, or too famous, or too rich, or too poor, to remember that you are our God and we are your people. We thank you for these great loyal fans and for this wonderful, exciting time. Shalom and amen.
And all that remains here at Daytona are the most important words in auto racing, the words 160,000 fans here are waiting to hear. You hear air wrenches running in the background, crews making last-minute fidgets. And now the field comes to life for the 36th annual Daytona 500. Let's go topside to Ken Squire and meet the starting lineup.
The starting lineup for the 36th annual Daytona 500. On the pole, the first rookie ever, Loy Allen Jr. Beside him, winner of 23 races at Daytona, but never the 500, Dale Earnhardt. In row two, it's the 91 500 winner, Ernie Irvin and Sterling Marlin. In row three, Rusty Wallace and the sophomore, Jeff Gordon. Row four is Mark Martin with the 85 and 87 winner, Bill Elliott. Row five is Texas Terry Labonte and Brent Bodine. Row six is the youngest of the Bodine brothers, Todd and Morgan Shepherd. Row seven, Ken Schrader and Michael Waltrip. Row eight, a new Winston Cup comer, John Andretti and the 90 champion, Derek Cope. Row nine, third yesterday in the 300, Chad Little and Wally Dallenbach Jr. Row 10 is Robert Presley and Ricky Rudd. Row 11, Jimmy Spencer with Lake Speed. Row 12, Bobby Hamilton and Ted Musgrave. Row 13, Jimmy Hensley and last year's pole sitter, Kyle Petty. Row 14, Dick Trickle and Jimmy Horton. In row 15, Dave Marcus makes his 27th start in the 500 and Rick Mast. Row 16, Greg Sachs and the 1989 champion, Darrell Waltrip. Row 17 is Texas Bobby Hillen Jr. and California's Joe Ruttman. Row 18, Jeff Burton and Harry Gant. Row 19, Chuck Bound driving for Bobby Allison and Hut Strickland. Row 20, Jeff Bodine and Jeremy Mayfield. The provisional starters, last year's winner, Dale Jarrett and Bobby Labonte. The field is just about set to move out and start the Daytona 500 for the 36th time. 42 cars are at the ready. Stay with us for our CBS flag-to-fly coverage.
The Daytona 500 is sponsored by the all-new Ford Mustang. It is what it was and more. Sears Diehard, the official battery of NASCAR. And by Budweiser, proud sponsor of the 1994 U.S. Olympic team.
Sold out for a year. All the preparations are complete, and we're ready for the Daytona 500. A total of $2.8 million at stake in the next 3 hours plus. 500 miles, 200 laps to be covered. That race record, that glorious 1980 event for Buddy Baker, who failed to make the field this year. Our colleague, Ned Jarrett's alongside as usual. Good to have you back, Ned.
Thank you.
As we get set for this one, some major changes, major developments on these cars to make them safer for this race.
Yes, we heard Rusty Wallace's speech in the driver's meeting the other day, and certainly there's a lot of concern, especially after what happened here with Neil Bonnett and Rodney Orr. NASCAR, before that, had mandated some flaps on the roofs of the car so when they spin out, that maybe it'll help to keep them on the ground. You remember last year, Rusty Wallace, he said that he flipped here at Daytona? Yeah, let's take a look at it again. As he comes out of the pack, the car almost immediately starts flipping over and over and over. But fortunately, Rusty was able to walk away. Now, NASCAR has manned in on Thursday here in practice, Richie Petty spun, and you see those flaps on top of the car that came up? Here they are in the garage area. The air inside of them automatically makes those flaps come up when a car gets backwards, keeps it on the ground, scrubs speed off, perhaps kept him from hitting the wall. They're similar, really, to the flaps on an airplane or the spoilers on an airplane that helps to keep it on the ground. So I think NASCAR has come up with something that's going to make those drivers feel a lot better out there today at the speeds they'll be running.
Thanks, Ned. Here's Mike Joy.
Ken, two drivers damaged their cars so badly in Thursday's 125-mile qualifying races that they'd have to go to backup cars. Number 90, Bobby Hillen. Number 95, Jeremy Mayfield. According to NASCAR rules, that means they must drop out of the starting grid and fall in line at the back of the pack for the green flag.
All right, here you see the field coming around to complete another preliminary lap. Let's take a look on board some of the cars. Here's Jeff Bodine, his bobsled at work over there at the Olympics. Well back in the field for the start of this one. There's Jeff ready to go to work. He's had his problems with his car number 7. 31 of the 40 starters from a year ago have changed drivers or sponsors, car makes. Ernie Irvin looking back off his bumper camera here. That's the most changes in the history of this event as you look at Ernie Irvin, Chris. A lot of changes.
Here. It's the hottest day of speed weeks. It's 77 degrees and getting hotter, and these cars have been practicing and testing in cool, rainy weather. Whether they've had a chance to adjust, we don't know.
Here you had a picture from inside of Dale Jarrett's car, last year's winner. This is a bumper camera. We're looking up the track from Jeff Gordon, that exciting sophomore. David Hobbs.
Well, I certainly don't want to put a hex on poor old Loy Allen on the pole, but you mentioned that Buddy Baker, the fastest winner ever here, is not here this year, didn't qualify. Well, I hate bad news for Loy, and that is that out of the pole winners, only 16 of the last 35 have even finished this race, and the last four haven't finished this race. So let's hope that Loy can break that streak today.
There's Lake Speed's camera. That's that roof camera. And that roof camera is all new technology, a whole new look at the world of racing. Field headed down into the back straightaway as we get set for a start. Always a dramatic moment. Always puts your hair on end. Feel your spine tingling at this time as we get set to see this one go. Earlier this week, received a note from Susan Bonnet. It goes like this. Our family would like to express our thanks to friends and fans for their outpouring of love and support this past week. We've been blessed by your prayers, your cards, calls, gifts, flowers, food, and visits. We are especially touched by a gift sent by William Barry Jones, a Purple Heart. Barry received in the Vietnam War, which he wanted us to have in memory of Neil. We all shared in Neil's life, and we share our sorrow with you in his passing. Neil would wish all of you to put this behind and move on. He loved life, he loved racing, and he would say, let's get this show on the road. In Christian love, Susan Bonnet and family. Dropping the flag on the great American race. And good luck to David Bonnet, who starts his racing career this spring. With Jeff Gordon. We're following Sterling Marlin in number 4.
And there's Todd Bodine in car number 75. Had an awfully good run here on Thursday. Dale Earnhardt has never led the first lap of a Daytona 500. Looks like he'll be denied this time. You can see he's back in about fourth place. Caught up on the outside there. Looks like Ernie Irvin is going to lead this first lap.
Never led the first one, never led the last one. Was hoping to change that this year, but he's stuck in fourth as Loy Allen lies third, first time across. On board, looking back from Ernie Irvin. Here you see Rusty Wallace right there ready to attack. Irvin's out in front. Rusty Wallace is in second. And the rookie, Loy Allen, back to third with Earnhardt in fourth as they head down the back straightaway, 3,000 feet long. Better than 190 miles per hour here.
It looks like Mr. Allen learned his lesson on Thursday. He's in that draft, and he intends to stay there.
Very careful driver. Had a lot of ARCA races. Had some wins on the Super Speedway in the Automobile Racing Club of America. There you see him, the number 19 in third. as the Robert Yates car stays in front. Ford, first, second, third, Chevrolet fourth with Earnhardt. Jeff Gordon.
A massive array of support for Earnhardt. Almost everyone is picking him to win. They expect him to lead early. He's back to fourth place. I wonder if this is by design.
See Terry Labonte just in front here of Jeff Gordon as he sneaks up on him. It's a little draft. Pulls alongside Mark Martin.
Mark Martin has a problem. Car number six is slowing down. One of the favorites in this race.
Coming by to complete lap number three of 200. Martin getting shaken out of that front group
a
bit.
Maybe he just, maybe the draft. He lost the draft there and didn't want to take any extra chances.
Sterling Marlin is back there in fourth. Holding fifth is Terry Labonte.
Yeah, I think Martin's okay. He just that outside line just went by him so fast it looked like he was slowing down. Here's Earnhardt making a move down on the inside, taking over third from Loy Allen.
There's Mark Martin picking it up under the number 24 of Jeff Gordon. Gordon running high. And from Jeff Gordon's view off that front of the car, down low, look at that number six of Mark Martin just sway at 190 miles per hour in front of him.
It shows you how important staying in the draft is. That's all they talk about is staying in the draft, and they wonder who's going to be behind you. Here's a move now for the lead.
Earnhardt trying to get to the bottom. Cut off. Wallace won't let him through. Earnhardt fades high. Earnhardt won one of the best races we've ever seen him drive yesterday in the 300 with a double fake on the back straightaway. That one out of the fire. Brilliant maneuver on Terry Labonte. His laps were running out. Time was running out. Two corners right down to the final moment.
Mm-hmm.
In the pits of Mark Martin, they're reporting that that car is still running well. He just got caught up and out of the draft.
Got caught out of the draft. That was all. My mistake. I thought he was slowing down. They were just running so fast and on the outside around it, but he's in great shape there right now.
We've got a pair of Fords leading, a pair of Chevrolets trailing. The field is four top heavy. And the 42-car field are 25 Fords, 12 Chevrolets, and 5 Pontiacs.
There you see Sterling Marlin's number four, booting it right through on the bottom.
That car has always been one of the strongest here at Daytona, the Morgan McClure car. When Ernie Irvin drove it, of course, he's a past winner. Ernie won here in that car. And Sterling Marlin has always run well here, regardless of what car he has been in. So it's a good combination. I think he'll be a factor all day.
Further back in the field, Greg Sachs is having an incredible run. He has come from 31st up into 18th in this car, number 77, and he's pulled that off in the first five laps, that U.S. Air car, number five, Greg Sachs.
He had an awfully good qualifying run here a week ago yesterday and didn't fare too well in the qualifying race, so he started pretty far back in the field, but yes, he is moving towards the front.
See Ricky Rudd, that new number 10, his own car. He tries to get it sorted out, gets up on the high side. There you see the number five just leading that picture. And that is the Terry Labonte ride. Tight formation, the back straightaway. Front six cars trying to draw away from that second pack of 15. That breaks back 7-7. Back with the leaders. Irvin first. You see Earnhardt in second. Marlin third. Rusty Wallace in fourth. Mark Martin, and look further back in here. Wally Dollenbach in the Richard Petty colors. Number 43 closes up on Bill Elliott.
Michael Waltrip in the yellow car down on the inside, car number 30. No one to draft with down there. It says, somebody come out and help me because that line on the outside is going by.
Wally Dollenbach from 18th into 12th with that car number 43 and challenging for 11th. And there goes the number 10, Ricky Rudd, up on the outside. Darrell Waltrip's little 6'4" brother.
Michael Waltrip thought he had a hole to get in there, but it didn't quite work.
Rudd is one of the few owner drivers in the race. It's a new team that he formed during the winter. Driver of number 10.
Chad Little in number 97. That Spokane, Washington driver who had a fantastic third place finish in the preliminary 300 yesterday Grand National race, working his way through the field. Little now running up in the top 15.
Michael Waltrip still has no one to draft with down on the inside in the yellow car, and they just keep oozing right by him. He's just going backwards.
7 laps complete. And there you see Ernie Irvin trying to win it for the second time. Getting out here in a hurry, leading now by 4 car lengths. Something conservative about Ernie Irvin. Earnhardt right there. All those tries, all those close calls for victory. And out of the back, last year's winner, the man that sat in the front row, Dale Jarrett, he's got a lot of work to do, Ned, if you're going to make the call you did a year ago.
Yeah, he really does. He sort of dug himself a deep hole here, had a problem in qualifying, and had to take a provisional spot just to get in the field. Had a problem in the qualifying race, I should say.
Taking a look back at the Black Shark, number 3, Earnhardt, from Ernie Irvin's first place car in the Daytona 500. Here's Mike Joy.
Ken, they've stiffened up the rear end of these cars. This is a 450 pound per square inch rear spring, but most of the teams are running on the right rear, a 400 on the left rear. In qualifying, they ran a 300 pound spring like this one, or even softer, 250, 225. They made the cars a lot stiffer, and if they need to make them even stiffer, they can put a spring rubber in here and stiffen that car up just a bit more. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, Mike, the reason they had to stiffen them was up because in qualifying, they all softened them right off to unheard of low spring rates. And the reason they did that was because NASCAR mandated over the winter that the back rear deck had to be an inch higher on the left side of the car and 2 inches higher on the right side of the car to get more spoiler up into the air to make these cars more stable. Well, racing drivers being what they are, they said, heck, if they're making us tilt the car back of the car up, we're going to put some real soft springs on here. And they all ran like motorboats in qualifying, and they got them loose through the banking, maintained high speeds for qualifying, but of course you can't race these cars with those real soft springs on the back, so all gone stiff again today.
Thank you, David. John Andretti on pit road and has been in there for some time, over 38 seconds. Battle for the lead. Earnhardt is there.
Rusty Wallace trying to follow by, but Ernie Irvin sort of swings that door. And look at Jeff Gordon coming up in there in the car number 24. He has moved up to fourth now.
The 22-year-old Jeff Gordon into fourth.
It's amazing that the Gordon, he just announced his engagement, disappointing any number of young ladies around.
Yeah. Wednesday night, Butch stays up on John Andretti's car, the Billy Hagan car, which had a great run in a 125-mile qualifier. And there is the youngster, Jeff Gordon, knocking on the door of this car. Number 2, Rusty Wallace, who lies in that third spot. They shake him up down the back straightaway. Again, a challenge for the lead. This time it's Irvin to the bottom. Number 28, Ernie Irvin. Back into first place. And you're riding with him as he scoots down to the bottom and makes it look pretty easy.
After 10 laps of speed, 187.110 miles an hour. That's moving along.
Well, Earnhardt got himself, he led that one lap, Ken, and got 5 bonus Winston Cup points. Anytime a driver leads a lap, at least once during the race, they get 5 bonus points. Now, they don't get bonus points every time they lead a lap, but the driver who leads the most laps then gets 5 bonus points.
Rusty Wallace almost getting covered up back there behind Ernie Irvin and Earnhardt. As snuggling right into third comes Jeff Gordon. Man, what a man on a mission he is out here. What a clash he ran a week ago. Keeps on finding holes and diving into them. Up to third, you see Wallace in the black and yellow now. And Brent Bodine on a good ride, up to fifth. Mark Martin right there with him on the outside. Here's Mike.
John Andretti had a great race Thursday, but it's a little short today. What happened, John?
Well, we're not sure. Something happened with the motor. It dropped the cylinder right at the start, right at the green flag, and we just went back and we're just going to try and figure out what it is and get back in the event and see how good we can do.
He's raced IMSA cars, Indy cars, and Top Fuel dragsters, and so far a short Daytona 500. They suspect a broken rocker arm in the valve train.
For the lead. 13 laps are complete. Irvin, Earnhardt, Gordon, Wallace, Brett Bodine, and Mark Martin now the top 6 just outside Sterling Marlin. Darrell Waltrip fading back. He'd made a good run, moved up through traffic. Now he is slidden back to 35th. Back in a moment. Back at Daytona. Today's overhead shots are from the Goodyear blimp Stars and Stripes from Pompano Beach, Florida. At the controls is Captain Richard Daniels from Burbank, California. Thank you, Captain. Taking a look at the leaderboard here as we move into this race with thus far no cautions. Ernie Irvin in front, Earnhardt second, Mark Martin, and now there's a big change in that, dramatic change, as that car of Jeff Gordon has jumped all the way into second. That was after 15 laps complete, looking further back through the field here. Ken Schrader staying right up in the hunt.
You know how fast they're going? The first nine cars cross the start-finish line in 1.2 seconds.
The car number 24, Jeff Gordon, the big surprise a year ago when he won a 125-mile qualifier. This year came to Daytona, won the Busch Clash to start things off. Got underneath Earnhardt, little help from Brett Bodine to make it work. Here he is challenging for the lead. Here's David Hobbs.
Jimmy Macon, Ned Jarrett up in the commentary booth, a bit worried about last year's winner. Dale, what's wrong?
Well, right now the car's running hot. Having to back out of it and just kind of get out in some clean air to make it cool down a little bit until we can get a caution flag and work on it. So that looks like we're going to be in pretty good shape unless we get us a caution flag where we can fix it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, boys. There's the story on Dale Jarrett, who started in the rear of the field today to fight his way up through this thing, and things are not going well for the Joe Gibbs team as you see Dale in the back straightaway now.
And you see how much empty space there is up in front of him. He's a long way off. He's not drafting anyone. He did come up and pass Darrell Waltrip a lap or two ago, but he's about three-quarters of a second off the pace of the leaders.
Lost a motor in a 125-mile qualifier, and what he did, other cars trying to take avoiding action, and in the wall, six of them beaten up in that crash.
What a difference a year makes.
Well, it looks as though Jeff Gordon got out of the draft, and now the two leaders are pulling away from the rest of the field. It shows the importance of staying in line.
It's Earnhardt in second, Irvin up in front. That means that Jeff Gordon got his hands full trying to hold on to third spot. As you look from Ernie Irvin, the leader, and our live coverage from Daytona back at Dale Earnhardt. Remember that Irvin's won this race on one previous occasion. Earnhardt, after all of those years, making his 16th start in the 500, still looking for his first win here. 59 on his career, six national championships, but never Daytona in the 500.
Our pole sitter, Loy Allen, has fallen to 19th position, the number on his car.
Here comes Earnhardt back another time on the attack. Wow, that 28 looked just unstable for a moment there out of turn two.
A little loose coming off of that turn. Now, Jeff Gordon, Chris mentioned that he had dropped back. He has picked their draft up now. He'll be back with them by the time they get back to the start-finish line.
Here's the story further back in the field. Bobby Labonte, remember he started back in 42nd? Well, he's up to 22nd now and still closing. Here he is under Elliott taking 21st position. Remember a year ago, Ned, at Talladega, when he was out back and ran right up in front. In fact, he was running with the leaders when he ran out of gas on the last lap. Bobby Labonte and that number 22 doing a heck of a job again today.
Well, he was a rookie last year, but I'll tell you, he's a quick learner. He's a former champion of the NASCAR Busch Series, a very fine young race driver, was a younger driver of Terry Labonte, former champion of this division. But they switched from Fords to Pontiacs this year. Thought it might take him a while to get the handle and everything going well, and it didn't qualify well, but he certainly has a good run going today.
He had to get a provisional starting position to get in the race. It shows you how tight the competition is in NASCAR Winston Cup racing. When a guy that could run this well has trouble getting into the race.
Chris, we're being told that Jeff Gordon is on the radio to his crew, and he's saying everybody is loose coming off turn two.
Well, that might be what Chris mentioned at the top of the show. This is the hottest day we've had since we have been here, and that has a tendency to make the racetrack slicker. As the sun shines down on the asphalt, it makes it a little bit slicker, and maybe they didn't have their cars set up tight enough.
Loose, Dad. Tell the viewers what loose means.
Loose means that the back end is not sticking when they go into the turn or coming off the turn, either one. The front end is sticking better than the back end. They can make adjustments on that several ways. They have screw jacks on each wheel, on each coil spring. They can make adjustments there. Of course, they can make adjustments with the spoiler as well.
So when they make the first pit stops, you'll see those adjustments. Let's go down to David Hobbs.
Honestly, you chaps will never learn, will you? Loose is oversteer and push is understeer. It's pretty simple, really, you chaps, you know.
For the benefit of our European viewer.
Yeah, there you go.
Who's he?
I was talking to people down south, David.
23 laps are on any short track. 23 laps complete. And Andretti looks like they're going to call it a day in the Billy Hagan car. Look at this battle for the lead another time. Earnhardt is there getting
the
help from Jeff Gordon.
Andretti's Well, no, he's going out, but we do have a caution.
Caution is out. Yellow is around the track. And there's debris on the back straightaway as John Andretti finally comes down pit road and comes back on the track.
Well, this will be a break for many of those who were beginning to slip and slide. They want to get in and get some new tires, make adjustments on those cars. So it'll be a break for them.
Bobby Labonte's car has lost part of the aerodynamics.
Whoa, that's bad news for Bobby Labonte, who's having such a great run. We'll check on that car when we come back. Under caution. Back with you, and the entire field is on pit road. Quickly to Mike Joy.
Jeff Gordon gets a quick stop. He is in and out. He is fast. Now right behind him, the number 80 car of Jimmy Horton has a pickup crew. It's part Buddy Baker's crew. They brought the sponsor along, and it's part Jimmy Horton's dirt track crew from New Jersey. They've never worked together, and the speed shows. David Hobbs?
Of course, this is NASCAR racing at its best. All the cars were radioing in that they'd got problems. They were either loose or pushing badly because of that temperature change that Chris mentioned earlier at the top of the show. So they just had a caution flag, and everybody comes in, and everybody's changed tires, and everybody has changed chassis setup. And that's what makes NASCAR racing so great and so close.
Someone left a tire out there in the grass in that exchange of rubber.
Mm-hmm.
Here's Earnhardt back out quickly, and Lake Speed's number 15. Looks like he's found himself a place to run up there in second. We'll return to the Daytona International Speedway after this message and a word from your local station. We're back with you live at the Daytona International Speedway, the 500. Last year's champion, Dale Jarrett, rolling out after a lengthy stay on pit road, Ned. Doesn't
yeah, they've,
good.
They've raised the hood and put water in the radiator. That's not a good sign, really, but maybe they lost some water when the car was overheating.
Field is still under caution. Jeff Gordon's the new leader.
Jeff Gordon is just having a remarkable time here at Daytona. He loves this racetrack. We were talking about that move he made on Irvin and Earnhardt with the assistance of a very strong running Brett Bodine to win the Clash. If you missed it last week on CBS, it was a thriller. There you see him from the pace car leading him down by, and you see Ricky Rudd with his new team running in second. Earnhardt's in third. Lake Speed is fourth. Looking a little further back, Ernie Irvin fifth, Chad Little up to sixth, and Little is having a heck of a week. The Spokane, Washington barrister, finished law school, now up to sixth position. Todd Bodine's in seventh, Rusty Wallace in eighth, Kenny Schrader ninth, Labonte is tenth, Brett Bodine 11th, Sterling Marlin 12th, as we go back under green with 26 laps complete.
Mark Martin, who was with the leaders before, is now back in 20th place. Shows you what pit work can do for or to a competitor.
I would say they made some adjustments on Mark's car. Spend a little extra time in the pits to be sure to get those adjustments made.
And make that 27 laps complete as they come back under green. Here you see Jeff Gordon out in front. Car that Ray Evermann has produced. A year ago, Ray said that some of the guys on their pit crew were making their first time ever in the pits of Daytona. And look at this shakeout.
Ricky Rudd goes to the lead.
Gordon drops to sixth. Whether that's because he was out of the draft or the adjustments
out of the
right,
draft.
Well, yeah, we'll find out.
That's it. But I said Ricky's going to lead, but is he going to lead the lap to get the 5 bonus points? No, Earnhardt's going to.
He doubled it up. Earnhardt's going to take it back.
Yep.
Lake Speed comes with him in the second spot.
Now Rudd caught on the outside out of the draft, but now everybody's making draft. They get two and three press going into the turn.
Well, I wonder how much different the cars feel to the drivers after these adjustments have been made.
Well, yeah, it'll be interesting to see. New tires certainly will make the car feel different. Usually, it'll make the car feel much better to the drivers.
Look where Todd Bodine is in this mix.
Butch Boxcar 75. That's a great ride for Todd Bodine, the youngest of the Bodine brothers, up there in third spot. Blue, white, sort of a pink 75. I'll tell you, the guy that got chewed up on that one was Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, Gordon and Ricky Rudd both got put back in the field. We understand that Jeff Gordon has told his crew, hey, I'm just being patient, not taking any chances, which is very, very smart.
Back in 11th place, though.
Yeah, fell to 11th. Here's Mike Joy.
Jeff Gordon's had a pretty good week so far. The other night, he gave Brooke Seeley a ring with a rock the size of a lug nut. They're engaged.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Was that a big surprise?
Very much a surprise. It was our one-year anniversary, and he took me to this little French restaurant, and he had a private room, and then he popped the question.
Well,
yeah, he's just been full of surprises this week, winning the Bush Clash and proposing, and maybe he'll surprise us all today and win this race.
Congratulations. They met at last year's 125-mile qualifier in Victory Lane. She's the girl on the left in your picture. Now they're engaged.
The dating game at Daytona 500, Chris.
Been
on board with Gordon.
Been popping the clutch, now he popped the question.
Talented young man with a lot of...
Isn't he talented?
Right in his future.
13 years old, and he was handling those 700 horsepower sprint cars. And he is just a... If there is such a thing in this sport as the natural, he's one of them in the tradition of Earnhardt. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, from romance to the grittier side of life. We keep on hearing about tires, but you know, there's some pretty amazing statistics on these tires. You see this big, stiff sidewall tire. But of course, do you know how much of this tire is actually on the road on these 3,500-pound Bahamas? It's a strip, obviously the width of the tread, and it's about 4 inches wide. So you've got about 56 inches of tread on those four wheels, holding that entire 3,500-pound car up at close to 200 miles an hour. And when you go into these 31-degree bankings, a tremendous amount of the weight of that car gets transferred and shifted to the right front. That's why the right front tire is always so important on these cars, and that's where they jack the weight around. They can take weight in and out of those tires, which is what makes all the difference to the handling. And of course, when they're going down the straight at close to 205 miles an hour, the air, the cars definitely lift, and as they lift, obviously they lose contact patch. So down the back straight there, some of these cars are on some pretty skinny bits of tire, I tell you.
This picture's from Jeff Gordon's car. He noses up in there under Ricky Rudd. The tire war between Hoosier Race Tire and Goodyear was ended faster than Desert Storm after the Thursday skirmish in the 125s. All of them switched to Goodyear. Whole field is on Goodyear tires again today out here. But there was a big story all week about those Hoosiers who had taken the pole with Loy Allen.
Yeah, they were faster for a few laps, but in the race, they just were not what they intended for them to be when they came here.
You know, this is the biggest sporting crowd in the southeastern United States, 140,000 seats. Up until this year, they've added 5,000 now.
Dahlenbach down on the inside, three wide, battle for 11th, and Wally Dahlenbach squirts that number 43 STP car down on the bottom of the track. Looks like he's going to take the spot. Oh, no. Back on the outside comes the car of Jeff Gordon, and with him comes Michael Wallace. And look at Bobby Labonte. Whatever happened to that car, the report was that a piece of metal had come off it. It hasn't hurt him. He's running up in 13th position, challenging for 12th.
Yeah, I don't think it has affected his car at all. The car seems to be handling great. Bobby's doing a good job driving it, too. He was a rookie last year, as we said, but he caught on quick.
He sure did. Smooth race driver. I guess it's a family tradition. Running order after 32 laps have been completed here. Going back through the field, let you know where some of the folks
you know, in Thursday's qualifying race, Jeff Gordon was a front runner till he made his pit stop, and they made an adjustment, and his car went backwards. Now he's back in 16th place. It may just be that the man with the wrench went too far, perhaps in the wrong direction on the adjustment.
Doesn't take much with these cars. Of the 42 starters, all but John Andretti are still in the lead left. Andretti spent some time in the pits. He's 14 laps behind now. But all others are still on the lead left.
That's amazing.
Really?
Knocking these laps off. You get down 34 laps, and you're talking about getting up toward the 100-mile mark. You've covered, when they come around this time, 87 and a half miles of the 500. One caution today, debris on the back straightaway. It's Earnhardt in first. Ernie Irvin in second. Todd Bodine is in third. Rusty Wallace in fourth. Showing fifth is Schrader, sixth is Speed, seventh is Terry Labonte, eighth is Morgan Shepherd. That looks like Brett Bodine, ninth, and Ted Musgrave, driving for Jack Roush this year in 10th. On board with Lake Speed. Let me give you some telemetry out of that Ford Thunderbird. You see alongside Terry Labonte, his new ride with Rick Hendrick.
See those RPMs changing just a little bit. He got up to 6,600. 187 miles an hour at one point. Of course, it goes down a little bit when he gets in the turns. The miles per hour as well as the RPM. You'll see him climb back up a little bit on the straightaway. There's speed up to 188, 190. RPM's got up to 6,700. Now, when they're out there running by themselves, they can run flat out around here, and in a good handling race car, they wouldn't lose over a couple hundred RPMs in the turns. But when you're running in the draft, you're only off the gas. So that's the reason you see the variance in the RPMs as well as the miles per hour.
You see Lake Speed getting caught up. Brett Bodine got through on him. A couple of others being challenged out there. Mark Martin working on him some. Tight racing, and apparently that something has happened. That rusty wall of speed seems to have had an effect. We've gone pretty darn well out here.
Well, they seem to be considerate of each other out there, at least so far.
188 mile per hour average on the lead pack, and here comes Earnhardt.
Drivers have to have great respect for their fellow competitors to ride so close alongside them at these speeds approaching 200 miles an hour.
On board with Ernie Irvin now. Second place car, looking back at young Todd Bodine. Great ride for Todd today.
He's just sitting there, not attempting to pass either one. He's in the position that he would like to be. He just like to sit there and ride all day and then try to do something at the end. He has a good race car. Here goes Earnhardt high. Ernie Irvin coming in down on the inside. Now Bodine might follow him through. Let's see who he does follow. Is he going to follow Earnhardt, or no, he's going to follow the Ford. Since he's racing a Ford, he said it ought to be out front, so he's going to help push Ernie Irvin right on by Dale Earnhardt.
Or Earnhardt must feel like a lonely little petunia and onion patch, or vice versa out there, depending upon your... Take a look at that shot. On board with Ernie Irvin. Leader looking back at Todd Bodine into second, but not for long. Earnhardt back on the outside of the number three.
And if they run side, well, they're not running side by side for long. And Todd Bodine knew that he couldn't run side by side too long. Earnhardt, Ernie Irvin would get away. They don't want to lose the draft.
Wallace in fourth, car number two. Just behind them, Morgan Shepherd. Morgan Shepherd with the Wood Brothers car. Wow, that's wrong. There you see, that's Brett Bodine. No, it is Morgan Shepherd.
Yep.
I correct myself here. Morgan Shepherd is there. And he's got that next spot in the number 21. And then it's Brett Bodine.
You know, each car has a spotter high in the grandstand talking to the driver by radio. And the spotters now have a new role, and that is to tell him who he's running well with. You're better off with this guy than that guy. They get coaching from the top.
And it really pays off at the speed you travel around here at Daytona.
Oh, you have to have them now. They can tell you when you can get in line and a lot of things.
More the Daytona 500 after this.
The Daytona 500 is sponsored by Goodyear, number one in tires. McDonald's, what you want is what you get at McDonald's today. And by Valvoline Motor Oil. People who know use Valvoline.
With Chris Economaki and Ned Jarrett alongside, I'm Ken Squire, David Hobbs and Mike Joy down along pit road, bringing you the action of the Daytona 500, 36 annual. Taking a look at how they stack up right now. Ernie Irvin is leading this race, the first time he's led the 500 since he won it in 1991. As you see, Earnhardt is second, followed by Bodine. Looking further back in the field, Rusty Wallace has slid back to 10th spot. Sterling Marlin, 15th. Bobby Labonte, still a good story, after starting the last row and now finding himself in the 14th position.
Well, we've got 100 miles in, Ken, and we've had seven lead changes. That's almost as many as you see in a season of Formula One racing.
And it's been accident-free. We've had only one caution, if you're just joining us. That was for some debris on the back straightaway, alleged to have come off Bobby Labonte's car, but that doesn't seem to bother that thing. He is running hard, staying up here with the field, closed into the top 15 and looking good. Mike Joy has a report on pit road.
Robert Yates owns Ernie Irvin's car. Now, he's won the 500, as has Ernie, but they've not yet won it together. He's hooked up with Todd Bodine. Now, how important is it for a Ford driver to hook up with another Ford instead of that black Chevrolet?
I'll tell you, as far as I'm concerned, it's everybody's for themselves out there individually.
Well, let's get the other half of that story from David Hobbs up in Todd Bodine's pit.
Well, I'm
front with Troy Selberg, who's looking out the Tosh car. He and Ernie Irvin seem to be making a bit of a break. Are they working together deliberately?
Oh, yeah, the Ford team really worked close together here. In Daytona, it's, you know, the Ford against Chevrolet. We're real happy with this factory stores of America Ford Thunderbird. We just like that Ernie to work with us, you know, like he did with Todd when they were on the Busch team. And the Chevrolets are giving us a tough time right now, but we'll be around there at the end. Just give us some time.
Okay, that's from the words of wisdom from Troy. Back to you, Ken.
Tough skirmish up in front. Saw Bobby Labonte, everybody loose out there in two.
Well, Jeff Gordon was back in 16th place a minute ago. Now he's up to sixth.
Getting a report that Ernie Irvin was asking his crew to tell the Todd Bodine crew not to run him so tight in the corners. Now we've got one car coming in. Brent Bodine, number 26, is on pit road.
And he and Bobby Labonte got together just a moment ago. You said that skirmish up front could have done a little bit of damage to his Ford. Let's see what they do to Brent Bodine's car. Or maybe he has the tire going down, not taking any chances. He's going to change all four tires, it looks like.
Now, and after the end of last year, remember when he drove with a broken wrist for so many, drove one-handed up at Martinsville and all that? He says it's really such a delightful change to come back here and do some two-fisted driving. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, Brett Bodine's in, and they're doing a four-tire change under green. They're going to be lucky if they don't go down a lap here, putting more fuel in, so that's going to put him out of sync for the rest of the afternoon on all the fuel stops as he smokes his way out of the pits.
A 26-second pit stop on car 26.
And he will go a lap down. He's getting coming out of the pits right now as the leaders come by, so he will go a lap down. And yesterday in practice, Ken, Brett Bodine had one of the fastest cars in practice. I thought that he was a long shot to win this race. Not that he can't do it, but it's tough to come back from a lap down, but we'll see.
His car is owned by drag racer Kenny Bernstein, a big name in that straight line sport.
Look at this struggle for first place. On the inside, number 28, Ernie Irvin. Falling back now as Earnhardt goes for the lead. And here comes young Todd Bodine. You know, Butch Mock must know something. He brings cars down here. Remember, he brought them down for Lake Speed for Joe Rutman, Neil Bonnet. And in fact, Neil Bonnet, back in the old days of Mock and Raheely, they were major challengers to win this thing. They just build good cars for the super speedways, Talladega and Daytona.
They really do. They've had some awfully good runs here, and Todd Bodine having a good run here today. He might have the best car in the field right now. He has pulled away a little bit there. Ernie's car apparently getting loose, the car number 28. And here's Earnhardt going high. Todd Bodine might say, hey, let me lead this thing for a little bit.
Earnhardt going high like that reminds me of Richard Petty's style of a decade ago. He liked it up near that outside wall. I wonder if that's a choice by Earnhardt for the fact that the car is washing up there.
Well, it's probably the way the car is set up right now that he's sort of driving it up there. But you can see there, it slid up there then, Chris.
Yep.
Yeah, that was not by choice that he went up there. That's sort of like what happened to him last year when Dale Jarrett passed him on the last lap to win this race.
Bodine doing a dandy job. Ernie Irvin looking up from third spot, closing up on Todd Bodine in second, the Butch Mock car. Butch Mock, part of the Mock Raheely team that ran second here at Daytona back in the mid-80s with Lake Speed, probably 85.
And Butch Mock owns that team completely himself. He and Raheely have split up.
Wonder what's happened to Rusty Wallace. He's buried deep in the pack after the pit stop.
Well, there you see Rusty, and he is getting devoured.
Yeah, he started going back about five or six laps ago. Apparently, the car has gotten loose with him. Here's Kyle Petty in the car number 42. See Bill Elliott in the red number 11.
Now, that's about back in 25th spot. Bobby Hamilton just going by in the 40. There you see Kyle, who's off his pace today.
Look how high Elliott was running up above the top white line.
Jimmy Hensley down there on the bottom under Rusty Wallace and Robert Presley, the replacement for Harry Gandy. No, take that back. It was Chuck Bound, the 12 right there, Bobby Allison's car.
Before we had the only caution that we've had today, we started mentioning that some of the cars were getting loose and we were getting those kind of reports from the pit area. Well, we've run another 25 or 30 laps here again, so we're seeing the same thing happen.
Showing 50 laps now complete. 50 complete and 125 miles in the book. Same as a qualifier the other day and running just as tight. Again, young Bodine down on the bottom challenging Earnhardt.
He's got help this time on the bottom. He may take the lead.
For further back to see Jeremy Mayfield, Darrell Waltrip. Waltrip having trouble today. Front three across the line to complete 51.
Now Earnhardt is moving into some traffic. This is the first traffic we'll see in this 500-mile race today as he starts to overlap the slower cars.
Just behind these front three cars coming up on lap, and they're about ready to lap DW. He's going to lap down. Here comes Ernie Irvin, right up to the eye of the needle. It's around Mayfield, trying to get beneath. Mayfield drops to the inside, lets him through easily.
One
good little ARCA driver, that Mayfield.
Yeah, one
gentleman
of the contenders this year. Earnhardt now sort of driving his car up there, and he's sort of found him a dry spot up there, is one way to put it.
Got a cushion.
The pavement is getting worn here at the Daytona International Speedway, and you can get two of the wheels to run in an area where the pavement is not as worn. Many times you can get better traction, and I think that's what Earnhardt's doing now. A
couple of degrees make a difference?
Oh, yes.
There you see that battle for the lead, 75, going right back on the bottom, Earnhardt on the top. And it looks like Earnhardt really just turns that thing sideways and off the corner at 190 miles per hour. Just behind them, you see Jeff Gordon in that fourth position with Michael Waltrip, a good stout fifth, and directly behind him comes number 21, Morgan Shepherd there. Shepherd having a very good race. Gets it right down to the bottom. That Wood Brothers car is working nicely.
It is. It normally works well on this racetrack. Of course, they're past winners of the Daytona 500. David Pearson won for them here. And A.J. Foy.
Marvin Hedge. Tiny Lund.
Behind him. And Cale in 68 pulled it off.
Yeah, yep. So the Wood Brothers know how to set a race car for this racetrack.
Here's Mike with a report.
Rusty Wallace started fifth. He slid back to 29th. What's the story, buddy?
Well, we worked with a car, and it's a new car for us, but I really feel like we're going to get this thing worked out. Rusty said the car's real loose, so instead of taking a chance to tear anything up, we're going to wait in here and get us a caution or maybe a pit stop and tighten the thing up.
How will you do that?
Well, we got a spring rubber for the right front. We're going to put a little wedge in it, maybe tap a spoiler. We started with minimum spoiler because the car felt good. The temperature of the track today has changed dramatically since we've been down here, so we'll get it adjusted, and we can come back up to the front. Before I leave, Robert G., I'd like to tell you we're all thinking about you, and our prayers go out to you, man.
He's one of racing's top fabricators. Ken, I talked to three drivers who had spoilers on the rear at the minimum angle. Rusty Wallace, Morgan Shepherd, and Mark Martin all started the race that way.
Jeff Burton in the number 8, Mike, having his hands full for 30th position with Rusty Wallace. Meanwhile, car number 30, Michael Waltrip, on that restart was 17th. He's up to 5th, and Michael Waltrip is having a very good day in the Daytona 500 as we get through 54 laps complete. More from the World Center of Speed, Daytona Beach, Florida, after these messages. After 56 laps, 140 miles, here are the standings among the front runners here today. All in that lead lap with Earnhardt, Irvin, Bodine, Waltrip up there in the front four. Some of the ones that had great expectations coming into Speed Weeks having problems here today. 37-year-old Dale Jarrett, who won it last year for Joe Gibbs, not going to get a chance to be a repeat victor back-to-back. Only two men in history have ever done that. Richard Petty back in the early 70s, and of course, as you saw on CBS, Cale in 83 and 84, we first had those onboard cameras. Loy Allen's not having, I think he's doing all right. He's not up there. He's not in the front. He's 33rd.
He's staying out of trouble, getting a lot of experience here now, out there sort of running by himself there right now.
If you're just joining us, Loy Allen, first rookie to ever sit on the pole and driving a very wise race at the present time. Trying to get an update from the pits, make sure that car is running well. Loy Allen dropping another spot, being shown 34th, Chris.
He had some company back there, and Harry Gant, who's starting his last season as a driver, July 33rd. We expected more from Harry Gant at this point of the race.
The Hendrick cars are running well today. The Jeff Gordon car, in the midst of that, is back in fifth.
There's the other two Hendrick cars, Terry Labonte in car number 5 and Ken Schrader.
Eighth and ninth. Look at Earnhardt still using the outside, and it looks like he's dirt tracking that thing. I'm sure he doesn't want to be doing it up on a 31 degree bank, but watch on the next corner as he sits it up there.
But the secret is he knows how the car works up there. He may need that space later on in the race.
You know, the guy that's done that over the past few years has been Harry Gant. Watch this. Here comes Irvin to the inside. Irvin's led 33 laps. Earnhardt 24 to date.
There's how they get in line right away, isn't it? You can drive a Mack truck between them in the corner, but not on the straightaway.
Well, I'm pleased with Michael Waltrip. He's having a nice day, man.
He is having a good run. He had the fastest car yesterday in the Goodyear 300, but didn't finish. Had this half of the spoiler plow of the car.
Yep.
And
yellow number 30 running in fourth spot. Mike Joy is down on pit road with a racing legend.
Well, for the first time ever, Ken, there's a number 43 in the field, and this man's not driving it. Richard Petty, seven-time winner of this race, retired a year ago, and last season his car carried number 44. Richard's good to see 43 back out there, even if you're not behind the wheel. Wally Dahlenbeck doing a good job for you folks today, but who looks good to win this 500 since you can't?
It's a wide-open deal right now. Yeah. You know, we've run pretty good, Wally was. He said it's starting to smell oil, so we're starting to run into trouble. But as far as who wins the race, it's a toss-up right now because you see them cars get way ahead. All of a sudden, you see people that's not running good catch up. So just whoever gets the right draft all day long is going to be all right.
Richard's often said the best you can do on a given day is put yourself in a position to win, and circumstances will dictate the rest. That may be true today. Here's David Hobbs with another former winner of the 500.
Well, from one legend to another, I'm down here with Bobby Allison. 43 has never been driven here by other than Richard Petty, and isn't it 34 years since an Allison last did not drive in this race?
I didn't hear what you said, David.
I say it's 34 years since there was not an Allison in this race. How do you feel about that?
Sad. Just, but a lot of people have helped me a lot, and at least I'm able to be here in the pit area. But it's a tough deal. It's been the great American race, and we've had a lot of good days here, and so you do the best you can.
Well, you got trouble in turn four. Major incident in turn four. 7-8 cars collected. Hutt Strickland is in it. Kyle Petty involved.
Robert Presley was involved in it. Harry Gant is involved in it.
First caution of the day is coming at lap number 62, just as they came across for 63. That is the first for a major accident. We had one other caution, just for a little bit of debris on the track. First major incident of the day. There's Kyle Petty. Front end looks like it found a telephone pole on car number 42.
Bobby Hillen is involved in it. Remember last year he and Kyle Petty?
There's John Andretti's car number 14 crunched against the wall hard.
Jeff Burton's car was involved as well.
Got another car crawling back in, and that's the Bobby Allison car. We were just talking with Bobby. Whole right side of his car is stripped. Big marks down on it. There's Robert Presley's Mannheim number 54.
And Rusty Wallace is up against the wall. His car is demolished up there.
Bad luck for the second year in a row for Rusty Wallace, who made that impassioned speech to the drivers before this one started.
It's the driver's side. We hope he's all right.
Average speed for the race was around 172 miles an hour. They were turning individual laps. Here's Rusty getting out.
Yeah.
Wallace is all right. Flaps are still up. You see him on the back of the car. He's all right after a wild skirmish up here in the fourth corner. Just coming down by, you can see the nose of that car number two has been bloodied. The fluids leaking out. Number 90, Bobby Hillen going by. He escaped that. We'll give you a complete rundown on the cars involved in a moment. John Andretti slapped it hard against the wall. Concern for John here.
I mentioned that Bobby Hill was involved. He's still going around the track. He has a good bit of damage on his car. Pit Road is closed right now, Ken, because of the problems here on the entrance to Pit Road. Let's go to the pits and David Hobbs.
Well, I'm still in Bobby Allison's pit, and what a sad day for them. As he said, it's sad, and this is sad, too. The car badly damaged both sides, all four wheels. As you can see, tires exploded there. Mechanics feverishly working away to pull the bodywork off the tires. They'll put four tires on. They'll go around and do another quick lap under the caution, then come back in and do some more work. This car needs a lot of work doing to it, and that will certainly knock the edge off it as Chuck Brown goes out.
And he'll be back again in just a few seconds when he's done one lap. Look at that tire, completely torn up. He must have spun this car around a couple of times.
Chuck Bowne spun in a 125. There you see Robert Presley, who'll take over for Harry Gant in a year. Great Grand National driver for some years and a guy that's come out of a racing family. Bob Presley's dad, great driver. Now the pits are open.
No, pits are still closed, Ken. They're coming down pit road, but they can't stop and
but
make
they
a
can't
pit stop.
Stop. They've put the field down onto pit road, but they are not allowing them to stop. The pits itself are closed, but they're using that so they can get around some of the debris out here on the track. We'll be back in a moment with more of the story of this major incident in the Daytona 500. And once again, we're back with you at Daytona after on lap 63, a major incident has taken place in turn four. And they are still picking up cars in this area. The Hut Strickland car lies out there. Pit road is being used to drive through, but they are not allowed to pit their cars at this time. They're just using that while they clear up the track. Let's take a look now at what developed out here just moments ago.
Well, of course, a car had hit the wall on the outside, and then Chuck Bowne came on the inside of Kyle Petty, and they got together. Robert Presley had hit the wall on the outside, and then they just started going everywhere, nowhere to go. You see all the smoke. They couldn't see where they were going, and they started hitting each other. We'll watch it again at another. See, there's Robert Presley up against the wall.
The blue
and then
black
Chuck
car.
Bowne comes down on the inside of Kyle Petty.
12.
And they hit, and then they start hitting each other back there. Rusty Wallace got tagged from the rear by the 23 car of Hut Strickland, and that shot him into the wall. Of course, there's Hut in the car number 23. There's the car number 8 of Jeff Burton. John Andretti, now watch his car. It goes out of the screen, but he hit the inside wall hard. And there's Harry Gant spinning around in the green car. Here's another look. And you can see they just start hitting each other. And
watch Andretti in that orange and white car coming from left to right. And
yeah,
into that wall. That's a hard hit.
Yes, it is. Right on the left side of the car.
One more angle here.
Okay, you see the yellow car there hit Rusty right there. Hits him and spins him around. Of course, I don't know where Rusty would have gone, but anyway, he was there. There's Bill Elliott threading his way through.
Watch Andretti's number 14.
And of course, the other drivers back behind, there's Dale Jarrett. He was pretty far behind this. He was coming into turn three as this was happening, so he's waving to the cars behind him. Slow down, we got trouble up ahead, and you can see that smoke up ahead. Okay, pit road is now open, so they can come in and make their pit stops, and everybody will do it.
The right side goes up on Dale Earnhardt's car. Can of gas going in, the left side lug nuts going in. The jack band is key to the speed here. Now the left side lug nuts are off. How quickly David Smith gets that car in the air determines how quickly they can get the left side tires off and new ones on. Earnhardt's done just that. He's away.
In 19 seconds.
Great pit stop.
Still working to bring in Hut Strickland's number 23. We have no report on driver injuries yet. We'll update you just as soon as we hear anything from this major incident in turn four. Looking under Dale Jarrett's number 18.
I think what they're doing is changing the track bar. They're either lowering it or raising it, one or the other, to affect the handling in the turns.
Let's take a look at as many as we can give you that were involved in this wreck. Robert Presley looks like his day is over. For certain, Hut Strickland, the number 42 of Kyle Petty, Harry Gant's 33, Portland, Oregon's Chuck Bowne, Rusty Wallace for what, the third time in the last four Daytona 500s getting in trouble up here. Andretti, Marlin, Bobby Hillen involved in that crash. Some folks really keeping track of things out there in the infield. We'll return to the Daytona International Speedway after this message and a word from your local station.
We're back at the Daytona International Speedway, a major wreck off turn four, and let's take a look. Here is Rusty Wallace in the black car down on the inside. and Hutch Strickland coming in fast. Rusty had already slowed because the wreck was happening in front of him. Now we'll move ahead and we'll see just about that time he gets hit from behind as these cars spin in front of him, shoots Rusty right out into the wall. And look at Bill Elliott in the red car. He weaves his way through there. Amazing that he got through it. And Bobby Hamilton also in the 40 car down on the inside got through as well. And look at John Andretti now. He's in the orange and white car coming right through there. He'd already been hit. He hits Harry Gant right there and gets a little bit of a nudge. It shoots the car right into the inside retaining wall very, very hard.
Mm-hmm. Kyle getting wrapped by Bobby Hillen. Let's get a report from pit reporter Kyle Petty.
Tell him that. Kyle, go. Man, I can't interview myself. I don't know what happened. The 54 car and somebody was racing. One car got loose. The inside car got loose, got up into the outside car. They came back across the racetrack, and I got hit from behind and spun around, and now I think I got into the side of Chuck Brown. I think he was coming by, and I probably got in the side of him and spun him. And then you're sitting there, and I just put it back in gear and was rolling off, and that blind boy come through again and run over everybody, so I don't know what the deal was.
Thanks very much. Down to you, Mike.
Well, Troy Aikman's here in the pits of Sterling Marlin, and how'd this all come to be? I understand it's your first big stock car race.
Yeah, this first one. I've been spoiled a little bit. I got to wave the green flag, and then the Sterling Marlin's crew was kind enough to let me come down here and be a part of it with them.
I understand he was a visitor at the Super Bowl, and you guys got to talking about various things about your respective sports, and he got you interested.
Right. He came down for the San Francisco game, a championship game, and then he was there for the Super Bowl as well. And so we got to talking about it. He invited me down here, and I'm thankful for it. This has been a real experience for me, and I've got to be down in the middle of it, which a lot of people don't get that opportunity.
I don't think he'd want to have one of these 3,500-pound offensive linemen coming at him, but it does look like a lot of fun from here. Here's David Hobbs.
Rusty Wallace, after that impassioned plea in the driver's meeting on Thursday, what happened? Was it just one of the racing accidents?
I think this particular time was just a racing accident, to tell you the truth. I don't know what triggered it, but I do also remember looking up and seeing the 54 car heading straight for the wall. Then when that happened, I just throttled back and started slowing down and picked a hole through the smoke. And Hutch Strickland just couldn't slow down and got in the back of me, but it wasn't his fault. I mean, that was one of those deals where there's so much smoke and you're so far up on the scene, you're trying to get it gathered back together. Man, this makes four Daytona 500s for me that I fell out. I just like to thank all the guys back in the shop because this car, this Thunderbird, was flying. And I made a suggestion on a pit stop early and went the wrong way, and the car got real loose. And we were just going to wait and fix it, but didn't make it to that point.
Yeah, but last time you didn't finish here, which is also pretty dramatic. 3 weeks later, you were leading the points championship, so all is not lost.
Exactly right. I'm an optimistic person. I never say die. And I tell you what. After all that's happened down here and all the stuff, I'm ready to go back home, go to North Carolina, go to Rockingham and try to win it again like I did last year.
Okay, thank you. There you have it. Straight from the horse's mouth.
Week away, then off to Richmond, Virginia, as the Winston Cup Series gets underway for 1994. Go to a mile track, then to a three-quarter mile track at Richmond. Both provide excellent races. So Wallace is out. He's crashed out of the 91, the 93, the 94. Back in 84, remember he had a wreck down here in turn one, and he had a big side over side back in the 80s in a 125 mile qualifier.
Now again, we're down to 31 cars in the lead lap.
But what, one or two have been lapped? How many are we showing? Oh, we're showing more than that now being lapped. Yeah.
Well, some have been lapped. Of course, we lost a lot in that wreck. Yeah.
Todd Bodine has moved to the front. He's the new leader once the green flag will come out.
Great pit stop by the Butch Bock Motorsports team.
He'll have Dale Earnhardt, they say, in second. That isn't the way it looks, however. It looks like Jeff Gordon to me up there, and then Earnhardt as they come around. You see that 24 right there. And then Earnhardt back a spot.
Yeah, even as good as Earnhardt's pit stop was, two others beat him out.
Ernie Irvin comes next, and Terry Labonte in the 5 car, followed by Ken Schrader, Mark Martin, Morgan Shepherd, Lake Speed 9th, Sterling Marlin 10th, Jimmy Spencer 11th, Michael Waltrip 12th, and Bobby Labonte from that 42nd position, he's up to 13th. Bobby Labonte in the 22. Furthest back anyone's ever come to win this thing from 32nd back in 78. The leader of the Alabama gang, Bobby Allison, did that one. Last driver to lead the 500, Butch Mark Carr, Joe Ruttman back in 91. Ruttman wound up in third. Right now, Todd Bodine just blowing them off.
Yeah, whoa. Just pulling away. Boy, he really got a good start.
Great start for young Todd Bodine.
He has to look up in his mirror and said, what happened? Good feeling, though, to be sitting out there running by yourself.
You see Dick Trickle in the 32 fading high. Chris, I think we should tell the fans that if we get down to caution in the last 10 laps, there's a big change out here this year. They're not going to double them up. It's going to be single file for that last 10, so those leaders don't get boxed in.
When they double them up, it's the faster cars. The leaders are in the outside lane, and the cars are a lap behind on the inside lane. But it'll be a long single file after 10 laps to go.
They'll put them out in the back of those lead cars. Better idea, don't you think, Ned?
Oh, I think it is. A lot of people have lobbied that for that for several years. A lot of fans would like to see it because we've seen incidents happen in the past when a restart with four or five laps to go, whatever it might be, and you got lap cars up there mixing up with them, and I think that is a good rule that NASCAR has put into effect.
Front three, Jeff Bodine there with Earnhardt and Irvin, first, second, and third. Ford, Chevy, Ford, the top group. Jeff Gordon back there in fourth, followed by Labonte in fifth.
Well, after the second pit stop, all these cars have now had their second set of adjustments made on them, and they should be right. And we'll see how this affects the competition.
Just as fast as you say it, they change it. Here comes that number 24, Jordan fourth, Labonte, fighting for the fifth spot now as he tries to hold on out there.
Well, you can see with the fresh tires on how they're able to run side by side. After they run about 15 or 20 laps, they sort of seem getting single file and don't see as much passing because those tires get hot and they start sliding around on the track.
You're seeing the running order up there after 71 laps, 177 miles of the Daytona 500 have been completed for 94. Here on CBS with Ned Jarrett and Chris Economacki alongside Mike Joy and David Hobbs on pit road to bring you the action today. Olympic coverage coming up later. Really pull a sophomore sensation move in this one. And he just looked, you know, some drivers have a little reservation about these big 2.5 or 2.6 mile tracks. Not Gordon.
No.
He thinks this is a third mile.
He's not intimidated at all.
Two former winners back in 26th and 27th place, Dale Jarrett and Bill Elliott. You never know.
Yeah, there is another changing of the guard, Chris. There's no question about that. Look at this Todd Bodine strut his stuff. Earnhardt having to play second fiddle to him right now with Ernie Irvin in third, but folks, there's a long way to go.
Harry Gadd has been called to the pits. His car is smoking.
Yeah, Harry had been behind the wall after being involved in that accident. Maybe they didn't get all the sheet metal off the tires, or maybe something was pulled loose, so he's back in there. We mentioned Bobby Hill, and Bobby is still running. He is in the lead lap still. He didn't lose a lap. He was involved in that spin up there, had some sheet metal damage on his car. Here's Earnhardt trying to go for the lead
for first place. Lap 75, Earnhardt back in front.
And Bodine hung out to dry.
Ernie Irvin makes his move. He comes right up in there.
On the outside, just moves right around. That took horsepower to do that. He's got it under the hood of that Ford.
We're watching it live at over 190 miles per hour down the back straightaway, up through turns three and four on the 31-degree banking. Ernie Irvin, the 91 champion, back in front. And Jeff Gordon comes to third. Gordon again moving up top of the line back to fourth. Look at Sterling Marlin in the four car down to the bottom. Trying to get a little hole and find his way through. Nothing opened up.
There's the car number 27, Jimmy Spencer in the Junior Johnson car for the first time this year. Ken Schrader in the green car, new color design on his car this year.
The Dick Trickle car, that 32 car, in that group.
Dick had made an unscheduled pit stop, a green flag pit stop, so he is a lap down.
Trickle got his wrist slapped earlier for missing a driver deductions. They made him go to the back row for the start.
And they did that to a couple of drivers. How do you feel about that, man? You missed the introduction. All you got to do is wave your hand.
Yeah.
You forget to get up there and do it. You have to start in the back.
Well, that's part of the incentive for going, so you won't get penalized.
Doesn't matter if it's the biggest race of the year and you worked hard to qualify. If you aren't out there for the fans, you're in the back.
That's right. This is show business, so you got to get out there, and that's the only time the fans see them, really, with that.
Well, when you think of how those, like the Formula One guys, you never get to see them. They hide in their buses. They run out, they get in the car, and they run back. And here, if you don't perform for the fans, see you later.
Well, it's a different world and a different sport, really.
I'll tell you, I admire so much guys like Earnhardt. With all the pressure, he's lost his best friend. He was still out here yesterday signing autographs after he won that 300. Of course, everybody, here's Harry Gant coming in. Back end all battered in. Harry's last Daytona 500 is going to end early. At lap 76, it's behind the wall for Harry Gant. I'll bet you he brings it back out and tries to give it another go. But that car is beaten up, Ned.
Yeah.
David?
Well, Harry Gant's just bringing his car in on the black flag. And apparently the oil seal's leaking out of the gearbox and he's letting a lot of smoke, and NASCAR have black flagged the car. And of course, this is going to be Harry Gant's last Daytona 500 start. And next year, Robert Presley, who was driving the Mannheim Auctions car, also owned by another Presley, will take over the Skull Bandit for the 1995 season after Harry Gant bows out, and I'm sure will be very dramatic style. But today was not going to be his big day at the Daytona 500.
What can happen in 1 second? Nine cars pass the starting finish line this time. It's amazing how close they're running.
Bernie Irvin is still complaining to his crew that he's running loose out there. Car is not where he wants it to be, so you can be sure there's going to be some more adjustments, and there's plenty of time. He's right up there in it.
But he's doing okay. He's sitting out front. What would he be doing if the car wasn't loose?
Take a look at Morgan Shepherd, right tucked in behind Mark Martin. Mark is fifth. Morgan is sixth. Morgan's driven for nine different car owners and 12 500s. It's almost like when he won the National Sportsman Champ. What did he do, drive for nine different owners that year? He just showed up and climb in anything, go after points. Morgan Shepherd up in that top six. Here you see Bodine in the fifth spot.
He's an animal fancier. The local paper did a feature on him. He paid $200 for a raccoon. I told him I had a bridge he connected Brooklyn to Manhattan I'd like to sell him.
What a fancy raccoon. We've got one up on the farm we'd give him. Gladly.
The Daytona 500 is sponsored by your local Yamaha dealer, who invites you to see their exciting line of motorcycles, ATVs, and snowmobiles. A1 Steak Sauce, A1, it's how steak is done. And by Kellogg's, the best to you each morning.
We're back. The pits have just been opened on lap 81. There's been a major incident in turn three. Ernie Irvin was involved. Something had happened to his car, just fallen off the pace. We can go to Mike Joy and get an update quickly.
We told you how important these jackmen are, and Jeff Gordon has a new one. Ray Everett hired Barry Muse. Here he comes around to the front of the car with a jack. He runs a health club in Charlotte. Puts muscles on some of these other crew guys. He proves to be quick and fast. Jeff Gordon is once again. He's first in and first out of the pits.
Jeff Gordon doing a good job. The Ernie Irvin car has come on pit road. It's coming back out again as it fell back, and we hope to get have you see some pictures of it in a moment. You're riding out with Ernie Irvin. This incident developing up in turn three has taken two of the Bodine brothers out. Brett Bodine, Todd Bodine, Musgrave's car getting collected. There's the Jack Roush number 16, all torn up in the nose. This incident in turn three, just at the 200-mile mark of the 94 Daytona 500. And here's Brett Bodine's car being pushed in. Todd Bodine, a lot of damage, but we saw Todd climb out. He was okay. Brett appears to be all right. Doesn't seem as though anyone's been hurt in this. But again, the 28 car seemed to shuffle back, and then all of a sudden, everything broke loose. Let's take a look at a group of replays that we've assembled for you.
Okay, here we go into turn three. Earnhardt's in the lead, and Jeff Gordon and Todd Bodine bump, and that's Bodine spinning around down to the inside. See, Ernie Irvin had dropped back quite a bit before that happened. We had mentioned that his car was getting very loose. And then other cars start coming in as Bodine is spinning around. There, Michael Waltrip gets hit. There's Brett Bodine in the green car that gets pushed into the wall. Okay, a different look. Here's Bodine down on the inside, Jeff Gordon up on the outside, and you see they touch right there, and it sends Todd Bodine spinning the wrong way into the wall. The car comes up off the ground. The flaps come up, keeps it back down on the ground. Some cars get by okay.
But then all the smoke, there's Ernie Irvin coming down the inside. He had dropped back to about sixth or seventh position.
And that had happened right as they went down the back straightaway. Yeah. He'd been up there with the leaders and then fell back, but he was not part of that incident.
And see other cars coming through. Ooh. Jimmy Spencer there in the car number 27 gets hit, and there's Brett Bodine coming in, nowhere to go. There's Ted Musgrave in the car number 16. Michael Walter spinning around in the yellow number 30.
And Brett Bodine in the 26 getting caught.
It looked like Bodine.
One more angle as they come. I don't think Todd probably didn't know that Jeff Gordon was out there, and they just touched and sent him right into the wall the wrong way.
It looked as though Bodine cut across the bow of Gordon there.
And then as other cars come in, tries to slow down, well, they get involved. Michael Walter thought he was okay. He thought he was through it.
That
and then all
Spencer
of a sudden,
car.
He gets hit.
Put him right up off the bottom.
So another major incident here at the Daytona International Speedway. Here's a look from Ernie Irvin's car. Now, remember, he had dropped back just before that, and he sees all this happening. Whoa. There's Bodine's car had gone up on the wall. Irvin drives low, hoping that Bodine stays up there, and he does. So Irvin gets through okay.
Lake speed, and look how quickly your vision goes
away. Boy. Whoa. Yeah, the water and the oil and mess. He couldn't see anything. The miracle, he got through. But I guess he did.
Todd Bodine had a bad crash at Atlanta back in November for a national race. Here's Mike Joy.
Larry McReynolds is the chassis man for Ernie Irvin, and he said just before the caution, Ernie was getting a bit loose and started dropping back. What did you do to cure that?
Well, we put a little bit more spoiler on it. We've been adding a little bit of spoiler each pit stop. Fighting it while ago, and we still ain't quite got it where it needs to go. Everybody's got the same conditions to deal with, but this is the first hot sunny day we've had in 11 days down here, and the 125 was running cool weather, the bush clash, and all of our practice over the past few days, but we'll just keep adjusting on it. We got a lot of racing to go. Car still seems fast. We just got to get it driving a little better.
It's an important development. The car 15, Lake Speed, and Earnhardt's car number 3 have cracked windshield, and this could affect Earnhardt's performance.
There you see the cars involved in the second crash of the day, and the report is that they're all right. That's good news, Chris. Everybody's okay after this problem up in turn number 2 that looked pretty serious. And Jimmy Spencer, actually, he was very lucky in that one. The second major incident of the day, the third caution period after a crash in turn 3 here at Daytona. The good news is that all the drivers are reported all right after a 190 mile an hour get together in which Jimmy Spencer came from the bottom of the track, and it was reminiscent of some tragic accidents here earlier this week. But number 30, Michael Waltrip, was up on the outside and absorbed a lot of energy, but it looked like one of those cars grabbing for the outside wall. It's a hard hit for Michael Waltrip, but it might have saved him out there.
Yeah, it could have.
Yep.
We see the rundown. Rick Mast in 26th position is the last car on the lead lap. All of these are one or more laps down.
We've completed 207 miles, and from high above Daytona International Speedway, today's overhead shots are courtesy of the Goodyear blimp, Stars and Stripes. It's out of Pompano Beach, Florida.
Hutch Strickland, car 23, involved in that first accident, has made repairs and is now back on the track.
If you're just joining us, we've had some weather all week. 5 inches of rain the past 8 days. Then things have turned out beautifully. We have Bill France weather here today at Daytona. Mike Joy with a word.
Dale Earnhardt's team is ready for almost anything, even if it happens twice. They have not one, but two spare windshields behind the pit wall. NASCAR rules used to require that these be automotive safety glass. They're now made of bulletproof Lexan. So that crack, if it really doesn't hinder Dale's vision, he'll stay out there. If not, there's two here. And remember, he sits very low in the car, Ken, so he's probably only looking from here to here on that windshield. The rest of it doesn't matter.
All right. He does sit down in that car low.
Yes, the lowest of anyone that I know of.
But you can still see his eyes when you pull up alongside, right? I mean, when he gives you that evil eye, you pay attention. Restart getting ready to go, and we'll be with Lake Speed's car on this restart. Jeff Gordon will be in the lead. Chad Little will be second. Mark Martin, third. Morgan Shepherd, fourth. Dale Earnhardt will be in fifth. Terry Labonte, sixth. Saxon, seventh. Schrader, eighth. Irvin, ninth. Marlin, tenth. Lake Speed, will be in 11th. We're riding with him now. In 12th is Ricky Rudd, 13th Rutman, 14th Bobby Labonte, and 15th Dale Jarrett. What do you think he's got in that bag out there, Ned?
Huh? Probably ice. I don't know. They might have given him a little bag of ice when he came in to sort of cool himself off. Maybe.
Could he bag something left over from breakfast, maybe? I always like the story of Don McTavish. He won the New England 300 one time. Halfway through it, by leading by two laps, he pulled out this bag and ate his lunch while he was leading and winning the race. Here's David Hobbs.
Oh, just got shuffled back a little bit in the pit stop. I really couldn't tell what happened. I did see the 75 car get turned up into the outside retaining wall, and you know, when that happens at the end of the straightaway, it just, you can't stop. Everybody was trying to do their best, but everybody's running into each other trying to get through that, and man, what a mess.
The 16 car was running very strongly today. You confident for this year?
Yeah, Jack Roush has done a heck of a job with that car. You know, my car, Mark's car, looks good, you know, and the Family Channel came along, gave us a lot of support for Daytona and through the year, and I could see some good things turning out this year. You know, just sorry what happened. It wasn't my fault, but we tried to get through.
One of Wisconsin's best, Ted Musgrave, sideline today.
And one of the best for the future. Fifth at Pocono, that's a great race driver. Came out of the ASA ranks. You're riding with Lake Speed. We'll give you a look at some telemetry as we come down on this restart, which will be happening, what, at lap 86? We'll get it back to green.
Okay, Ken, you say he'll be starting in second gear, so that means he'll change twice. He'll go to third and then to fourth. He'll rev it up to about 6,500, 6,600, then change to third as they get ready to take off. There he is now, 68, 69, a little over 7,000. There he makes the switch up to third gear. You see the speed picking up as he tries to stay in the draft. In third gear, he'll run it up there to about 170 before he changes back to fourth gear.
Sterling Marlin just in front of him in 10th.
Well, he still got it in third gear. Whoa. Off to 173. Now he's back in fourth gear. Wave to the fellow behind and wave to the
fence. Do not try this at home, right?
That's right.
Do not try to go from third gear into high.
There's some of the cars that are one or more laps down. And
coming around, change of leadership. As they sort them out, coming off the corner, Spokane, Washington's Chad Little. The Mark Rippon team, car number 97, out in front. Back to the stripe with Mark Martin in second, Morgan Shepherd third, Earnhardt fourth, and Terry Labonte in fifth. They double up going into turn one. We mentioned earlier, Chad Little had a magnificent ride yesterday. The third spot in probably the best 300 I've ever seen on this track. It was a great race. Earnhardt pulled it off. He won everything except this, the 500.
Mark Martin for the first time out front today.
Earnhardt going up to second. Labonte to third. Chad Little falls to fourth.
All the low-numbered cars in the front of the field.
Martin's teammate, you just heard from him, Ted Musgrave, now out of the event. Wally Dallenbach sat in that chair a year ago. He's now driving for Richard Petty. He was crashed earlier in that other big incident. Three cautions to date if you're just joining us here in the Daytona 500. Two major wrecks. One in turn four. One at three. They've all walked away. A little further back here. Chad Little now falling to sixth. Morgan Shepherd fourth. Gordon to fifth. Chad Little to sixth. Irvin stays seventh. Greg Sachs, that's eighth. And look at this for the lead. Oh. Chevy versus Ford. How do you like that one, Chris?
That's something else there.
Chevy out in front, number three Chevy in second, and a Ford out in front. And then you got that Chevy running in third out of the Rick Hendrick stable, and another Ford. I tell you, Morgan Shepherd's having a great day.
You know, the Ford Chevy duel, the top people from both companies are on the ground today rooting for their particular nameplate. And look at that Chevrolet going underneath that Ford, but Martin's up to top all alone. He'll drop back as Labonte moves up to follow Earnhardt through. And Shepherd's right there.
Morgan Shepherd having another great run here. He finished second to Davey Allison in 1992.
Look at Martin go back.
Yep, no drafting help out there, and the train goes by down on the inside. Nothing you can do about it. You got it to the full board.
That 32 car, Dick Trickle, is running one lap down. He's the first car in the next lap back. That's 27th position. 27 cars stay in the lead lap as we get to halfway. Now look at this three-way battle. And in the middle is that lap car on board with Ernie Irvin. As he sorts that car out in fifth position. bumper cam looking back. Ernie Irvin. Here's Gordon right next to him on the outside. Jeff Gordon being challenged. It's the fight for fifth. They catch Mark Martin, the fourth place rider. On board with Gordon. On board with number 24, Gordon.
Look how close the side of that car comes to the pavement, Ken.
This is at 190 miles per hour, folks. We're at Daytona watching the 36 500 as Dale Earnhardt, after all these years in his 16th start, 23 wins at Daytona, but never in the 500 with more determination, with more grit than ever. His best friend in the whole world, Neil Bonnet, who did hundreds of miles of testing in this car number three, lost his life here several days ago, and this is the one Earnhardt wants. He told me last week, there's only one place for me. It's not doing interviews. It's not talking to anyone. I need to be in my car out on that track. And that's where he is, in that silence. You can't believe it's silence, but to Dale Earnhardt, that is almost perfect silence. Totally away from all these fans, from everyone, and doing what he loves best. Stays second, and Morgan Shepherd. What a great run for Shepherd and the Wood brothers. This is one of their best days in over a decade. They're right up in this thing.
Despite these 190 mile an hour speeds, Ken, the two parking flags have slowed the race average to 143.7 miles an hour. No chance of a record today.
Actually three with that little shorty for a piece of metal out on the back straightaway, and then two majors.
Shepherd goes to the inside of Terry Labonte. Mark Martin comes with him.
Now Labonte's hung out to dry.
And here comes Mark Martin. He wants to try to challenge down there. Now Shepherd slips up in front of Labonte. That might help Terry. Well, I don't know.
Mark's
got
help.
Irvin's coming through there, too.
Seven cars battling for the lead at the mid-distance of the Daytona 500. Look at this. Earnhardt in first. Mark Martin on the inside. Morgan Shepherd on the outside. Jeff Gordon's car giving us some shots here. Look at Terry Labonte's car just dancing, just on edge of the 190.
It's impossible to keep the car in an absolute straight line when you're running it that close and running in the draft. The air is affected so much that the car is going to, you can hold the steering wheel as tight as you want to and as straight as you want to, but it's going to move around a little bit with you because of the way the air is affected.
Jeff Gordon giving us these shots. Just amazing. 31-degree banking. Cut your vision off. Remember, you're down on the bumper riding with him. Look how tight they ride together, inches apart. And it's brought out a record crowd, as it does each and every year. They keep adding seats. We have another new grandstand this year.
Oh, it's what do we have here?
Huh, for good reason. David Hobbs has this report.
Todd Bodine, you were just having a great race. What happened up at turn three?
Well, you know, I was just riding along, trying to draft and get some drafting experience, and Ernie got loose and had to check up, and Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon had to check up, and I got a run on him, and, you know, I was just going to pass him, and instead of me getting past checking up with him, I was going to pass them, and I pulled out, and then Jeff pulled out, and I had to give him room, and evidently there wasn't enough room for him, and he got in the quarter panel. It's a real shame. The Factory Stores of America, Ford Thunderbird, Adidas came on board this year as a sponsor, and we were just trying to get some good time, good experience, draft. You know, there's a lot of people out there that give me a break. You know, a couple times I messed up, and they let me in. Even Earnhardt and Ernie, a couple of them, I'd mess up, and they let me back in line. But for some reason, Jeff just got a little anxious or something.
Well, both young kids at the Daytona 500, the great race, and Mike Joy's got more down pit lane.
Well, once Jeff Gordon got his radio communication back, and the radios are fine, but somebody was blocking their frequency or a microphone was left open. It didn't contribute to the crash, but it took him a while to explain to his crew what happened. And his version is that Ernie Irvin got loose, and as Irvin got loose, Gordon had to check up, and he and Todd got together. Nothing intentional, no trying to jump into line. Racing incident.
Another new leader, Morgan Shepherd, in car 21 out in front. And look at him go.
96 laps complete. Four more to halfway. Only the second Daytona 500 that Morgan Shepherd has ever led. Drawing away. Shepherd with the advantage. Will he lead at half distance? We'll know in a moment. Stay with us for more of the Great American Race. We're back, and at halfway, Morgan Shepherd out of Conover, North Carolina, driving for the Wood Brothers of Stuart, Virginia, one of the proudest names in racing, is leading the 36th annual Daytona 500 with Mark Martin in second, Terry Labonte is in third, and Dale Earnhardt is in fourth. How do they race? From inside Jeff Gordon's car. Listen to this.
Okay, that is close racing, folks. I think it gave him a little bit of a tap.
We heard there was a ting in there you could hear.
Yeah.
Earnhardt closing in on Terry Labonte another time. What a great day for Terry Labonte. His first ride of that Rick Hendrick car, stays right there in third, and there's Morgan Shepherd up in front. He's having a ride. Morgan Shepherd, second time he's led the 500. This is his 11th start in the race. Tries to hold on to it here. Coming down, about to put a lap on Hut Strickland, who was in one of those earlier incidents. Morgan Shepherd, he was second, 92, to the late Davey Allison. Here's Morgan out in front, and Terry Labonte coming back up to second spot. Earnhardt stays third.
Morgan Shepherd has been right up there in the top 5 to 10 all afternoon, and now is really flexing the muscles of the Wood Brothers Ford.
Wood Brothers have won this thing 4 times. Tiny London, 63. Cale Yarborough, 68. Foyt, 72. David Pearson.
And Ken, they've named a grandstand after Tiny Lund here.
Yeah.
That's
so
great.
Over there in turn 2, he'd like that. He's been overlooking the lake. Remember when Tiny had the record for what, the biggest bass, 55 pounds? What fish was that? But anyway, great fisherman, a great race driver. Good friend. Lost his life in the mid-70s at Talladega after he won here in 1963. And what a dramatic, remember that dramatic story where Marvin Panch was to drive and he got upside down in a sports car and burned, and Tiny helped rescue him, so they put him in the car and he came out here and won the 500.
Here's Terry Labonte going for the lead.
Earnhardt coming for second. Shepherd falling to third. Martin on the move. Ernie Irvin up. That's the top 5 right there, folks, in the Daytona 500. And right behind them comes Schrader. Now, Schrader had some great laps yesterday in that practice period. You were talking earlier about Brett Bodine, but that Schrader car looks stout.
Yes, it really did. And this is the eighth Daytona 500 that Terry Labonte has led. So he's been up among the front runners a lot.
20th lead change of the race. 8 drivers have led this race, and we're just past the halfway mark.
That's only on the line. That doesn't count what they're doing out there when they're fishing around first in the back straightaway. That's only at the stripe. It's Earnhardt for the moment. Shepherd coming back. 3-4 car draft on the bottom. They can overhaul him here.
Yeah, they got a run, honey. Boy, did they have a run. Well, I think Morgan had to back off. He went in there so fast that he had to back off and go high to keep from running over Earnhardt.
Or he'd have drop-kicked him into the Atlantic Ocean.
Whoa! That's what the draft of several cars working together can do.
Just behind in that grouping, you see Martin in third, Irvin is in fourth, Schrader in fifth. Jeff Gordon up in that group, Sterling Marlin in the 4, having a great run.
Morgan back to the lead. Here comes Mark Martin down on the inside. He wants to go for the lead. He's got a good run off of turn 2 with Ernie Irvin following him through.
Wait a minute. What lap is this? Is this lap 200?
You would almost think. There's Ken Schrader in the car number 25. Jeff Gordon in car number 24. Morgan having to go up to the high side.
Coming around to complete 105 this time. You're riding with the best stock car drivers in the world. You're in the 36th annual Daytona 500. CBS Olympic coverage upcoming.
This is the Olympics of stock car racing, Ken. It's some race.
The gold medal here, the lion's share of $2,700,000 this afternoon. There's Schrader in that green car down at the bottom. He's getting under Earnhardt in the number 3. Jeff Gordon right in there behind, giving you these pictures off the front bumper of his car. stays first. Urban stays second. But not for long, the way they keep shuffling those positions. Back to the pits as they lap Harry Gant, and Mike Joy has this report.
Well, if you're studying numbers, Dale Earnhardt led lap 103. Ken, as Ned pointed out at the top of the show, he's never led lap one. We know he's never led 200 the last lap, but he's led every numbered lap of this race except 96 through 99. And he was in fourth place in those today. So back up, let's go to David Hobbs.
Well, on the side of Leonard Woods brother's car is the name Codrow. And everybody said, what on earth is this Codrow on the car, thinking it's some sort of trick sponsor. But in fact, it was way back when Neil Bonnett drove for the Wood brothers, there was a crew member called Cod. And Neil embellished his name and started to call him Codrow. And then it became one of these names where everybody called everybody else Codrow on the team. And Neil himself then became known as Codrow the driver. And in memory of the day, Bonnett drove so well for the Wood brothers back in the early 80s and late 70s, they have put the name Codrow on the car in memory of Neil Bonnett.
Put the name Mark Martin on the top of your leaderboard right now for 107 laps complete, but under heavy challenge with Dale Earnhardt right alongside. We'll return to the Daytona International Speedway after this message and a word from your local station. After 109 laps, 272 and a half miles, Earnhardt had become the leader, and dropping back was Mark Martin into fifth. Ken Schrader had fallen to sixth. Sterling Marlin further back in that top 10 group. Big wholesale change of positions.
It's amazing. When we went to commercial, Mark Martin was leading, and then Earnhardt took the lead, and now Ernie Irvin's the leader. It's the 24th lead change of the race.
And that's about the biggest lead we've seen anyone have.
Well,
Bodine had it there, remember?
Yeah, on the
Todd
restart.
Bodine got a restart. Yeah. He pulled off like that, and then that went away. That's about as good as it gets, folks, for a lead here in Winston Cup stock car racing. Take a look at this. Here's Dave Marcus in that 71. He's getting his engines this year out of the Rick Hendrick folks and hopes to be doing better, and he's running 21st right now. And back there with him, you see the car number 7, Bodine's car, which is running 22nd. That's his own team, his new team. And, of course, he's a little anxious about how things are going at the Olympics with his bobsled over there.
Marcus tied Richard Petty's record of 27 consecutive Daytona 500 starts when the green flag dropped today.
27th time out. He's still in those wingtips, Chris. Still wears wingtips.
Right. I'll always remember it. I asked him why he wears wingtip shoes. He says, I got a great deal on them.
Well, back up in front with Ernie Irvin in front, and then it's Earnhardt right there, Jeff Gordon. Well, you got the veterans, and you got some brand new great kids in this group. Jeff Gordon, just 22, and he's up to third once again here today. He had a fifth-place finish in the 500 last year. There you see Terry Labonte tearing right along after him. Just behind him comes Schrader. I'm really impressed with Ken Schrader. All week long, he seems to have been building for something, and he's right in it. Take a look at that high line. That's that old Harry Gant, Richard Petty line, way up there out of two. Car works, and down he comes, still in second spot.
You know, it's interesting, Ken, the horsepower output of these cars with the restrictor plates is about 430. Back when the record was set for this race, the same size engine was delivering 700 horsepower.
Yeah. Here you see Ernie Irvin out in front. Remember that he won this race. Took it all in 1991 after he started on the outside of the front row. It was the year he defeated Sterling Marlin, one of those second place finishes that haunts Sterling Marlin race after race, year after year, never winning but coming in second so many times. That was the case in 91 when Ernie Irvin came home first. And that was the year that Joe Rutland came home in third spot in this race. That many days ago that race came to pass and gave Ernie Irvin all of the publicity and the fame that comes from this event. Darrell Waltrip has said he won the championship, he'd won a lot of races, but until he won Daytona, he had no idea what it meant to
him. You know, over the years in racing, Sterling Moss was never able to win the World Driving Championship. Tony Bettenhausen could never win the Indianapolis 500. It's certain drivers.
And Roy Ruby.
Yeah. And we just wonder if Earnhardt will be able to make it in the Daytona 500.
And that Sterling Marlin can come through and get a victory. He's got a great team this year. He's got that Morgan McClure car. Tony Glover is crew chief for that number four. He's as good as you can find. Look at Jeff Gordon and the 24 comeback net.
Yeah, and to see an Earnhardt run side by side, Ernie Irvin is pulling away a little bit up there in front of him.
But Terry Labonte's there to help Gordon. Pulls him right underneath.
His teammate.
Gordon is about half of Earnhardt's age. Absolutely unfazed by running door handle to door handle with Earnhardt.
Racer. Laps complete, 1:15. Laps rolling out here. Three cautions, 287 miles have been completed in the 500 as Ernie Irvin seeks that second win. And a sophomore tries to take it away from him right now. Terry Labonte's been here for a while. He'd like to taste victory today, and he certainly looks capable. Here's Mike.
Well, the Ken Schrader pits, they're having radio problems. So the technician suspects that maybe the plug into the radio may have vibrated loose, the radio bouncing around a little bit, but they have lost radio contact with their driver. David Hobbs?
Well, Mike, these NASCAR drivers are generally reckoned to be the Iron Men of racing, and so they are, but even they get a bit tired from time to time, and Persona Wheels have come up with a somewhat novel idea to help these drivers. You have to grip the steering wheel so hard in these racing cars because otherwise it gets pulled and kicked out of your hand. And you just mentioned the word vibration. And what happens when you're gripping the wheel so tight that the ends of your fingers go numb? In fact, the blood falls out the end of your fingers. I noticed towards the end of my career that happened a lot. So what they've done, they've developed these grips here so that the driver actually grips the wheel. His fingers slip right into those slots, and you have to grip the wheel literally half as hard as you would normally to get the same effort. And it's a much, much improved way, and some of the NASCAR drivers here are using it, and of course a lot of the IndyCar drivers use it as well. So it's yet one of those other little things that happens to improve the breed, as it were.
We need to get one for Chris.
That's right. You know, it's 300 miles in the race. We have not had an engine failure. Years ago, this race used to see car after car go to the pits out of the race with a smoking engine.
So, here's how it stands. Ernie Irvin's carrying number 28. You believe in numbers? Well, that number 28's won this 500 five times. Lorenzen in 65. Baker did it. Cale Yarborough a couple of times. And in 1992, the great Davey Allison. Will it hold true today? Stay tuned. Back with you at Daytona, Ernie Irvin, Jeff Gordon, and Dale Earnhardt just put a lap on the pole sitter, Loy Allen, 27-year-old guy, just got knocked down in turns one and two as you take a look at the standings here in this event. After 119 laps have been completed today, getting up toward that 300-mile mark next time by.
Loy Allen's running in 25th place, so there's still 24 cars on the lead lap.
Incredible. So there you see the leader. It's all Ernie Irvin for the moment by a car length or two. And then you have Jeff Gordon running right there in second spot. There's Ernie, the 91 Daytona 500 champion, now driving for Robert Yates, and those colors so familiar to race fans for Davey Allison. And here's Jeff Gordon. At 21, he came in here and finished fifth in this race a year ago, won the 125-miler, Rookie of the Year a year back. Now Earnhardt is running in third as we take a saunter back through the field, and Earnhardt closes in still another time, but does that high fade up in turn number four. That's been his mark throughout the day. Mike Joy.
Ken, there's quickly activity here in the Dale Earnhardt pit. They have tires on the wall. Earnhardt reported in. He feels like he has a tire going soft. He's going to ride it a lap or two and see what happens, but they jump quickly to action here and are ready to service him unexpectedly.
Okay, we'll follow that story on Earnhardt as we fade back through the field and give you some other pictures and tell you some other stories here in the Daytona 500 for 94. There you see Earnhardt up on the outside, and here's Bobby, or rather Terry Labonte, in his new ride, holding on to fifth spot. Terry's been here for years trying to win this race. This looks like it may be one of his very best shots in his 16th start. And then here comes Sterling Marlin.
He's in the fifth spot. Labonte running fourth. And Ken Schrader right behind him. He is running in the sixth position.
In seventh is Mark Martin. He's been up in front today and slid back. And directly behind him, here you see Schrader, followed by Martin. Here's Kenny Schrader. Ken Schrader staying in fifth spot. Then Sterling Marlin behind him. They swap him around again. Martin
running in the sixth position. Then right behind him is Lake Speed, having a good run here today in the Bud Moore Ford.
Go on board the Lake Speed. Lake Speed
running a higher groove than those cars in front of him. Car just must feel comfortable up there.
So many lead changes. Every board here, the computer board has one in eighth, one has them in seventh, and one in sixth.
You know, the
that's
last
how fast they're moving around out here.
The last pit stops are made exactly 100 miles ago. Remember, we can only get 100 miles maybe out of a tank of fuel. Well, with a carburetor restrictor plate at 7/8 of an inch, you get a lot better mileage. We'll see how much further they can go before they're forced to make a green flag pit stop for fuel.
Well, here's Morgan Shepherd in that Wood Brothers car. What a great day they're having.
Back to ninth now. He led for a while, but settled in back there just riding out until he gets some new tires on it.
And I would think that would probably bring Bobby Labonte into the picture. He was in ninth, and Morgan just went by him.
Okay,
so there's Bobby Labonte in the 10th spot. And remember, he's come from dead on the rear of the field. He started in the last row as a provisional today.
And he is the last of the 10 cars that are in the lead draft. Those 10 cars have sort of broken away. Bobby in danger of losing the draft. He needs to pick up just a little bit. There's Dick Trickle in car number 32. Dick is at least a lap down.
Well, he is a lap down. 25th position on the tail end of the lead that second lap. First,
and then comes Ricky Rudd, owning his own car this year, driving a Ford, car number 10. Ricky in the 11th position.
Driver combination. And there's Loy Allen. Remember, he just won a lap down. He's already fallen to 26th position. This is how he's running on the field in that car number 19. You're going to hear a great deal more about Loy Allen. Brave kid, really put him on the pole. And here's Dale Jarrett, and Dale's been having his troubles.
Well, he's worked his way up to 12th now. Yep. So he's much better than he was earlier in the race. They've made a lot of adjustments on that car, but he's been coming up through there. Look how close he sits to the steering wheel. Ken, when I drove race cars, my arms were outstretched. I sat back. I wanted to be a little bit more comfortable, but they say that you have more strength in your arms sitting that close and driving the car.
Got to report the spoilers coming off the back of car number 33, Gant. They may bring him in. Now, there you see Bobby Hamilton just behind Dale Jarrett in the 18 car. Bobby Hamilton gets a new ride in that car number 40 this year.
He's currently 13th. Dale Jarrett just passed him, and Bobby is 13th.
And here's Derek Cope, former winner back in 1990 of the event, with his new colors. Boy, they were lucky on sponsorship for Cale Yarborough's team.
Well, they're putting a lap on Darrell Waltrip, a former winner of this race. Darrell's having a tough ride today.
Going well for him. And there is that number 12 car Bobby Allison has put together, and Chuck Bound, the former Grand National Winston West champion. Chuck Bound in car number 12, who was involved in that earlier altercation.
He's
right behind him,
down.
And he's a lap back.
Yep, 27th position.
Yep,
he's being shown.
Running pretty good right now.
Yeah,
getting
not
a good style
bad.
Ride out of that.
Yep. With the sheet metal battered up to the aerodynamics are not too good on the car right now. But
I'm sure you were watching, but I'm surprised. There's the Jimmy Hensley car coming next in the frame. About three laps, we expect some pit cars. Jimmy Hensley is being shown as 15th on the field. That's a new ride for him.
Well, the pit stop should be coming up soon. This will be the first green flag pit stop to the race, and the pit crews are really going to be under the gun, because what happens now could win or lose a race for their driver.
Greg Sachs in the 77, the Jasper U.S. Air car, is 16th. Remember, this was the ride that Musgrave had a year back. Sachs takes over. And there you see the number 9 getting a chance to play here. And that's Joe Ruttman, who's had some good finishes out here in the 500. He took over for P.J. Jones. There was a big war going on back in the garage area. P.J. left the team, and Joe Ruttman got the assignment at the very last moment for Harry Melling.
Shown in 17th position.
The 80 car, Jimmy Horton, remember the guy that left the track at Talladega, right out over the top of turn one? Jimmy Horton's back, and that's his ride. He's driving the Moroso colors today for car number 80. Moroso's own car, the Baker car, did not make the field. Randy LaJoy gave him a great ride yesterday, with riding fourth and fifth in the race until the engine expired in that 300.
You know how times change. Leader Ernie Irvin is moving up on the back of Bill Elliott, a two-time winner of this race, who is about to go a lap down.
In the lead lap is Jeff Bodine here. He's running in the, 19th position at the moment. So he's picked things up. I'm amazed at how well Dale Jarrett's gotten back into this thing.
Well, they made a lot of adjustments on that car. Let's go to the pits of Mike Joy for a report.
Ned, in about five laps, green flag pit stops will begin. The window's about 5 to 12 laps from now. Richard Childress, for example, Earnhardt's car owner, just sent two emissaries, one in each direction up and down pit road. Because you need a partner to draft with, they want a partner to pit the same time they do so they can go back out and not be running on the track by themselves. Those kind of conversations and deal-making are going all up and down pit road right now if they have to pit under green.
The leader is Ernie Irvin. Jeff Gordon stays second. Dale Earnhardt is third. Sterling Marlin is fourth. And Labonte is fifth here in the Daytona 500. Laps whittling away into the 300 zone now. And as they do, who's that getting that car? It looks like Bill Elliott all the way up on the outside.
Going a lap down.
And getting himself a lap down. He's back in 24th position, Ned.
Bill just not having a good day here today. Chad Little coming into the pits in car number 97. Chad was being shown on the lead lap in 22nd position. There he is.
It looks like he's out of fuel. He came in so slowly.
Well, they look like they're trying to go under the hood as well. They're not attempting to change tires. They're trying to get the hood open.
Pin stuck? Something's amiss there. Here's Ernie Irvin into traffic. 130 laps, 325 miles complete. On board with Ernie Irvin as he's about to lap Bobby Hillen.
Bobby is the last car now on the lead lap, running in 22nd position. Bobby was involved in one of those wrecks. His car is not as aerodynamic as it was.
Field coming in. Big group of cars coming out of pit road. Jeff Gordon, Earnhardt, Labonte, Mark Martin, Lake Speed, Schrader, Labonte, Bobby, all on pit road. Here's Mike.
Most of them were Chevrolets. Ken Earnhardt, Jeff Gordon, and Terry Labonte had all agreed to pit as a group. Some of the Fords came in with them, and Schrader, Ricky Rudd. Earnhardt, the right two tires are on. They're going to left sides as well. Mark Martin will get four. Here's Ricky Rudd coming in. His Thunderbird will also get four tires. Ernie Irvin stays out. Jeff Gordon, left side of his car is up so he can get four tires. Usually when the first guy gets four, everybody does the same. First of those stops completed, and Earnhardt leads the charge off of pit road.
Green flag stop. Irvin stays out. Ernie Irvin stays on the track. Ricky Rudd is still in. Wally Dollenbach still on pit road.
Morgan Shepherd coming in.
David Haas.
Well, here comes Morgan Shepherd in for his pit stop. So, on Thursday, he got out of sync with the pit stops. He decided to not make one and put new tires on in the 125-mile qualifying heat and lost a lot of ground. As you can see, they're giving us a more aerodynamic spoiler. The car must be running loose. But they've got out of the sync of that lead group of Chevrolets. Is that going to be a bad effect on them? Are they going to get tied up with some other fast Fords?
What do you think, Ned?
Well,
33 yep. Complete.
It looked like the Jackman just slipped there on the 12 car.
Chuck Bound.
Yep, that's going to cost him some extra
you
time.
To Leonard Wood
and the pits. Here comes the leader, Ernie Irvin, and Sterling Marlin coming into the pits. If Dale Jarrett stays out there, he's going to be the leader of this race.
Wow, what a comeback.
But he has a pit stop coming up pretty shortly himself. He won't lead this lap because Ernie Irvin went across the start-finish line in the pits. Was 18.7, a fantastic pit stop. Let's go to the pits of Mike Joy.
Well, this wasn't a Ford Chevy deal. It was a next-door deal. Irvin pitted next to Sterling Marlin just about, and they come in the same lap, having been left out on the track by the rest of the pack last time by. If they both get similar pit stops, this should not hurt them, but Irvin's is quicker. He's away. Now Marlin's car drops down off the jack after four tires, and he goes out. They won't be drafting together when they get up to speed.
18.7, a great stop. We're seeing Jeff Bodine on pit road. Kyle Petty has just come in. The new leader of the race is Dale Jarrett with Bobby Hamilton in second. Jarrett leading. Let's see if he's going to stay out there and try to pick up that 5 points
yep.
for leading a lap.
He is.
Here's Jeff Bodine coming back on the track as Dale Jarrett crosses the stripe. Right with him is Bobby Hamilton. I believe they're showing them first and second.
That is correct.
Dale Jarrett in first and Bobby Hamilton in second.
He'll probably stop this time around once he has picked up those five bonus points. He doesn't want to stay out there too long because he's about a second off the pace with those older tires on. So he needs to get in, get some fresh tires. He'll drop farther behind if he doesn't.
So there they are on the back straightaway. You're riding with and wearing that Dallas Cowboy hat that does not exactly please Joe Gibbs. The helmet of the Cowboys, the Super Bowl champions, goes with Dale Jarrett.
Well, he's staying out one more time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's see if the 40 car stays out as well. Indeed, it does.
Yep.
Here you see them coming across the stripe. And Bobby Hamilton up in second spot. Dale Jarrett in first. Unofficially, we're seeing Morgan Shepherd in third. And probably Dale Earnhardt fourth. We'll wait on that one just a moment. But for the moment, Dale Jarrett, what a comeback story this is. Out of this race in the early going, he was a provisional starter. He lost a motor in the 125s, and all of a sudden, that Jarrett kid's back.
Well, of course, he has a pit stop coming, so he's going to be back about from 12th to 15th. He was running 12th before this round of pit stops started.
But you'll recall when the race began, that car was off its feet. We were talking, Ned, about how it was running slowly. He's picked himself up, picked his way through the field and through two bad wrecks. And he finds himself a contender, although he's being challenged right now. The 40's trying to go around him on the outside. Here's Bobby Hamilton trying to lead. Hamilton up on the outside, getting boxed in for just a moment. No place to go. You see Chad Little just in front of them. They may take him inside and outside going down the back straightaway.
Let him going down the back stretch.
Whoa. That'll get your attention. That's Bobby Hamilton out of Nashville, Tennessee. Good ride. And Kyle Petty running very slowly there, and you saw that picture.
Battered car, Petty's wheeling.
Yep. Let's see if we're going to get Jarrett in. We'll take a quick break and be right back. We're back with you at Daytona, 1960, when the Goodyear blimp began live TV sports coverage. Today's shots are from the blimp, Stars and Stripes, out of Pompano Beach. And we're under caution for the fourth time today. Doesn't look like a major, looks like the second minor one of the day. Two major incidents in turns three and four, if you're just coming on board for the 500, have eliminated several top contenders. We'll get back to that story in a moment. Just tell you that just after we left on that commercial break, we saw Dale Jarrett and Bobby Hamilton both pit their cars, and this caution flag was not particularly advantageous to them, was it, Ned?
Well, no. If they had stayed out one more lap, they could have pitted under caution. But, you know, they had to make that pit stop, and so it really won't hurt them that much. They'll get to catch up to the field. They were going to be about a half a lap behind, so I guess in one sense it is good for them.
20 cars remain in the lead lap. We're showing 140 laps now complete of the 200 to be run here today in the Daytona 500. That means we're at 350 miles. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, here we are in the Wood Brothers pit waiting for Morgan Shepherd to come in. I was just about to interview Lennon Wood as to why they had gone at a staggered pit stop compared to the rest of the field. As you can see, the car was loose because they were trying to bash the spoiler up on the car to give it more spoiler. When they rejoined the race, apparently it was even looser than it was before. And, of course, it was Morgan Shepherd that had that spin, and we're waiting for him to come in now. So it's not a good time to interview Leonard himself as they're preparing for their car to come in. They'll top it up with gas. We're now on lap, 140-odd? Obviously, they can't go quite to the end still.
But it'll be interesting to see how many cars stop now. Those that stop probably need new adjustments and so forth. Others will be take on gas just to take advantage of the delay.
Probably so. And, Chris, this was a major break for Bill Elliott. Did we see him come in? He had not made a pit stop. We saw him get lapped. Now he's back in the lead lap. Let's go back to the pits.
There we see the Wood Brothers car coming in. I can't see any signs of damage. More spoiler being put on the back. They're really giving that spoiler some stick to try and get it up in the air. 40 degrees minimum. They're going for the maximum. Mike Joyce got more for us.
You see them pumping up the rear spoiler on Mark Martin's car. They did the same thing on the last pit stop. Rather unscientific adjustment, but it might give them a degree or two. Minor aid to handling. Four tires for Mark Martin. Everybody else on the last pit stop took on four, so here's $1,200 worth of tires that's been on there for, about 25 miles. And now they've got new ones.
Expensive day at the races.
thought the seats were tricked.
Yeah, those tires get expensive.
155 mile an hour average and dwindling here in the 500 with this fourth caution of the day. We were mentioning that some of the top runners have had some big problems out here. We've had two big crashes earlier in the going. We're pleased to report that no one was hurt in those incidents, but it sure tore up a lot of great equipment, and we'll get back with more on that in a moment.
This Daytona 500 race summary is sponsored by Goodyear, number one in tires.
Let's take a look at a race summary right now here. After 355 miles, it's showing 12 leaders thus far in the race, and lead changes growing. They're reporting 30 lead changes, and the average speed, as we mentioned, is well down from the record of over 170. And the cautions, 18 laps thus far, four different periods, and six cars officially out of the race. Yeah, maybe.
Well, yeah, a lot of them have been in for long periods of work on the cars, but it's amazing with the major crashes we've had there. There are only six permanently in the garage area.
Well, let's talk about those for just a second, Chris and Ned. John Andretti out of the race. Two of the Bodines have crashed out of this thing. That's tough sledding out here today.
Well, those were hard hits some of those fellows took. These were not minor bumps.
John Andretti, very fortunate. He got a flush into the wall. Jimmy Spencer took a very hard hit in the back stretch. Got his car tore up. Todd Bodine, we were really concerned about him. He's just fine after his car crashed out of the event in turn number three. And we're one lap away from the start. It's been an Irvin Elliott battle as the majorities. And they're putting one of the Waltrips in the back for speeding in the pits, we're told.
That one right there. That former right winner there. Of this race, Darrell Waltrip. Darrell is already having enough problems.
Today.
He's already two laps down.
We were talking a few moments ago about your son, Dale Jarrett, out here and how that caution might have worked against him. Instead, it worked for him.
Well, it worked for him because he had just gone back out onto the out of the pits when the green flag or when the caution flag came out. He had four fresh tires. He came in when everybody else did and took on fuel, capped it off, and got back out and hit up now in third place.
While the others were changing tires. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, I'm down in Bill Elliott's pit, and they've just done a 61-lap run without refueling. And, of course, after that pit stop, they've gone out, and they've got 59 laps left. And according to Mike Beam, his crew chief, it's going to be a shoe-in to go to the rest of this race without a pit stop. And, of course, Junior Johnson looking very Sphinx-like as usual. Mike Joy, what have you got for us?
Well, Jeff Gordon's crew says, not us, we can't go. And everybody else along here, I told them how many laps to go, and they all winced and said, it's going to be close. And that's as close to a prediction as they would get.
Now they're waving the caution flag again down here as if they may go another lap. Oh, the caution lights are not working in two turns, we're being told. Getting a report that the caution lights, and the lights are on here. I think we may get another lap before they turn them loose.
Yeah, we definitely will as we see him waving that flag. And this will help those that are going to try to stretch it and go the rest of the way because they're burning less fuel going around here at the slow speed than they would if they were running full speed. So there will be some that'll try to go if there are is no other caution flag, some of them will try to go the distance.
Well, that's going to be interesting because it always comes down to this. It's amazing. Some will make it, and of course, some won't. There'll be guys stopping with a lap or two to go. So we'll be waiting for the restart after these messages.
Back with you once again at Daytona. They are still under caution. They spotted some debris in turn two, and Earnhardt, Irvin, Martin, Bobby Hamilton, Morgan Shepherd, all coming in, putting in a splash of fuel here. We see Brett Bodine, Wally Dahlenbach. Let's go to Mike.
Taking out around a wedge on Earnhardt's car. The gas man running along trying to get that last little drop in. This could be a good move for Mark Martin and for Ernie Irvin, both of whose teams said it was real close on fuel. I don't think Dale Earnhardt can go the distance even with that topping off. It's about three laps outside the longest they've run under green at one time today. It'll sure make it interesting if and until the next caution flag flies.
146 laps will bring them to 365 miles. They're in here at lap 145, so that is pretty tight.
That's running it a long way, no doubt about it. But Bill Elliott has already done it.
Fumes.
We know that he's gone over 60 laps.
Fumes.
I like all the wiggling on the backstretch. And I asked David Pearson one day why he did that. And he said, well, I'm doing it to warm up my tires. I asked another driver why he did it. He said, I'm doing it to clean up my tires. And the third driver I asked why he was doing it, he says, because the guy in front of me is doing it.
Well, that's about right.
Derek Cope settles in 98 as the leader. You see that just in front of him up in that outside groove is a car on the tail end of the lead lap. I believe that's Bobby Hillen getting set for a start. Ready to go with Cope, Marlin, Lake Speed, Dale Jarrett in the first four. Cope first, Sterling Marlin, Lake Speed, Dale Jarrett. Fifth is Jeff Gordon. Sixth, Bobby Labonte. Seventh, Horton. Eighth, Joe Ruttman. Ninth back there is Terry Labonte, followed by Ken Schrader and Bill Elliott. On board with Lake Speed as we come down for a start.
He's running in third place. Sterling Marlin there in second place. And look at him go four, five wide down into turn one.
And they made it.
Telemetry giving us a look inside a Lake Speed car as they come to full song and on the back straightaway.
This is an opportunity for some of these cars to get a lap back. Bobby Hillen and the Chuck Bowne car are lap down.
Jarrett slowing down, bottom of the racetrack. Fields pouring by him there.
Well, he made a gallant run from 41st to actually led some and was still in contention here. And then on the restart, I guess something went wrong.
On board with Jeff Gordon. Right up underneath, Ricky Rudd's number 10.
There's still two abreast up front. We saw this here last year. A couple of lap cars that were trying to get a lap back, and some of the cars that had not been running up front all day up there with them, and they just simply couldn't get away from it. It boxed the cars up back behind. So we'll see what it does here this time.
Rudd back there in that 12th position, and Dale Jarrett on pit road. In car 18.
Going to him sort of slowly. That doesn't mean, doesn't look very good for his chances of getting back out.
Car number three. Backing up just a little. Don't want to take too much of a chance here, maybe.
He might be. He sees all the crowd up there. He knows that there was trouble last year when we had this very same type situation. There was a big wreck here on the front straightaway. And so he might be just backing off to stay away from it in case it happens.
Laps now complete in the 94 Daytona 500, 370 miles down. As we get down to decision time, and there you see a frustrated Dale Jarrett. Last year's champion, not to repeat. Only two drivers have ever done it, Petty and Yarborough.
Some going three to deep into turn three. Can they? They're still three deep coming off the turn. This is not the place to be three wide. Now they get down to two wide. Ernie throwing up his hand. Slow down here a little bit.
Sterling Marlin brings the number four, the Morgan McClure car, back into contention. And now number three begins to work his way up. Can't wait any longer. Earnhardt's got to get with the program.
That's formidable traffic in front of Earnhardt.
Now they're beginning to string out a little bit up front. At least the front two cars are not running side by side, so that leaves a little bit of room for some passing, and some are doing some passing. There we're looking in on Earnhardt as he tries to make a move. Does go by Schrader.
Ooh, goes by Labonte. Goes by Cope.
Wow, he had a run going that time. Two laps ago, he was behind all of his pack, and now he's right up there in, what, about sixth or seventh place. That's Dale Earnhardt.
That's the same kind of the same kind of composure he showed yesterday. Backed off, waited, and the comfort level of that race car when he wants it, it's there.
Here we go, three wide again as Morgan Shepherd comes down on the inside of Greg Sachs and Ernie Urban.
See up on the outside. Number three, tucked right up there with Ernie Irvin.
Mark Martin coming. He's going very high. As Sachs goes high, Martin had to just drift up there, too. He didn't want to touch him.
Martin getting around Sachs. Back they come with Sterling Marlin in first. Lap car in second position as they come through your picture. That's Dick Trickle.
Late speed is second, but here comes Ernie Irvin down on the inside, taking over the second position.
On board with late speed in car number 15.
Irvin pulls away from him just a little bit.
I think Lake Speed has been a big surprise in this race today. Stayed up there, stayed out of trouble, giving Bud Moore's car a whale of a ride.
Had a great run.
Off four. It is still Sterling Marlin possessing that lead with a lap car, and then Ernie Irvin in second. Here's David Hobbs.
Dale Jarrett from back to front to in the garage. What happened?
Just burn another piston there on the restart. Same things that I did on these things under caution last year aren't working this year. I don't know what the deal is. It was fine down the backstretch when I cleared it out and went to take off and couldn't go.
There you have it, Mike Joy.
Cale Yarborough won this race 2 years in a row as a driver. Now he's a car owner. First, Cale, strategy. You didn't come in on that last caution flag. You're playing for another caution?
Well, we hoping, you know, there may be another caution, but we couldn't go all the way anyway. So we just stayed out trying to get our position a little bit on the racetrack. We've been a little bit loose all day, and now he's got all over his windshield from following that 90 car. But we go hang in there. Derek's doing a good job in the finger hunt now to Bill Thorne.
He led on the restart, and due to oil on the windshield, has faded back out of that lead pack.
Yes, he has, Mike, to 16th position now. Derek Cope driving for Cale Yarborough as Sterling Marlin in his 12th performance stays out in front trying to win his first 500. And you see the Dick Trickle car in second. That's the 20th position car on the field. Second in the race is that number 28. Ernie Irvin right there, former champion. And Lake Speed having a great day for Bud Moore.
There we see Jeff Gordon going up high. He's trying to close up as we watch him. Mark Martin moves out in front of him as he comes off the turn.
Nine times, Sterling Marlin, second place. So many times had it won. Had it won here. Had it won at Talladega. Had it won at Bristol, Tennessee. And it's gotten away from him. But right now, he's in command. And that Morgan McClure car is stout.
That is a healthy machine.
Remarkable what Earnhardt can do with that Richard Childress equipment. Plays it any way he wants it. Here's Lake Speed with Morgan Shepherd down on the inside. Morgan and Speed dicing for fourth, and it's Morgan's for the moment. Oh, the Wood brothers are having a great day here. Love to see that happen. Couldn't find better people in racing than the Wood brothers. 279th Winston Cup start for Sterling Marlin, son of famed alfalfa farmer racer from over in Columbia, Tennessee, Cuckoo Marlin, who won a 125-mile race here at Daytona years ago. There's that tiny Lund grandstand back on the second turn on the outside, that new facility just put up in memory of a great former champion here out of Harlan, Iowa, the 63 winner for the Wood brothers. Here you see that number four, Sterling Marlin, staying in front. Do you think those other guys are toying with him? Is Earnhardt just waiting? He's not showing everything he's got, nor is Irvin, is he?
No, I don't think they are right now. They're trying to conserve fuel and
let him break it up front.
Yeah. And how much less fuel does a car behind the leader use than the man breaking the draft?
I'm not sure it's a great deal now, Chris, because if you're running out front, you're running pretty well wide open. But if you're running behind and have to get on and off the gas, well, then that is putting more fuel into the carburetor. So I've talked to some that say they can actually use less gas running out front than they do running behind.
Yeah, using acceleration pump on the carburetor. Yeah.
Dick Trickle was given the move over flag, and indeed he has. And Ernie Irvin's rear bumper camera looks back at Dale Earnhardt in third place. Around Brett Bodine, they fly through the tri-oval area of the 2.5 mile Daytona Speedway. Down to the inside moves Ernie Irvin to challenge again for the lead. battling for first, and Ernie Irvin, 1991 Daytona 500 man, is back in first, and here comes Morgan Shepherd on the inside, number 21 moving up.
Trying to pass Earnhardt, trying to take over third.
There's Jeff Gordon back in it. Been in it all day. From the outset, that 22-year-old has given them all a fight.
He's giving Earnhardt a boost from behind.
Riding right into the sun. That's got to bother you a little.
It'll bother you some on this racetrack because you go right out of the sun into the shade. The banking down there shades the turns in one and two. So it's a little bit of an adjustment.
With Ernie Irvin, you're riding in first place at the Great American Race.
The Daytona 500 is sponsored by Splitfire, the patented performance spark plug. It only costs more until you use it. Smooth Busch beer and easy drinking Busch Light. Busch, the official beer of NASCAR. And by MasterCard. It's more than a credit card, it's smart money.
Back with you at Daytona, where there have been 32 lead changes thus far in the 500. There are better than 161 laps now complete in the 36 running. Averaging 151 miles an hour out here. They've covered 402 and a half miles, so we're down into that last 100-mile bracket. We were talking about those lead changes. They've had twice as many for the record. But the interesting thing here is that 13 different drivers have swapped the lead. Now, the record for different drivers leading in the 500 is 15. That's 1974 and 1989. Richard Petty and Darrell Waltrip, the winners those years. So that record may come today. 13 different drivers have led thus far, and it looks like the shuffle might well continue. Here's David Hobbs.
Well, I'm with a Woods, but it's not a brother, it's a son. Eddie, you're the crew chief on this car. Are you going to have to stop again before the end of this race?
I don't know. I think we're going to roll them and try to go all the way, but, you know, it's a gamble. We don't know whether we can make it or not, but we're probably going to try it.
Morgan Shepherd spun on the back straight there, and with those pit stops, you managed to stay on the lead lap. That was a pretty lucky deal, wasn't it?
Yeah, we're okay right now. We did lose after about 30 laps, but, you know, we're going to give it a shot. You know, hey, I'd like to say hello to Susan, Kristen, and David Bonnet. We love you. We're thinking about you.
Thanks, Michael.
Well, this is the reason why Sterling Marlin thinks his 9 second place finishes can turn into a win this year. This team, led by Tim Morgan and the McClure brothers, that Ernie Irvin abandoned late in last season, is now Marlin's ride. He's had 9 seconds, but don't be too hard on him for not winning. Another young fella had 8 runner-up finishes before he got his first win, and then he won a bunch of them. Bill Elliott.
Yeah, but it's been a longer time, it would seem, for poor Sterling Marlin. At this moment, however, holding fast in that second position, qualified fourth for today's race.
Yeah, I don't think there'll be any question about what he'll win this year. Maybe today. But I think that he was a very good choice for that ride.
We've had eight different winners in the last 8 years here. Keeps moving around. He could become number 9. Love this shot down the back straightaway. This is 3,000 feet long, folks, and they just gobble it up in these race cars. Jeff Gordon, and remember, he's fifth. Just in front of him is Earnhardt fourth, Labonte is third, Sterling Marlin second, and Earnhardt leads the pack.
Lake Speed still up in that lead pack. He's the blue car back there in the sixth position. Running in seventh is Mark Martin, who's still very much in it. Those 7 cars, a little bit of a lead over Greg Sachs, who is running in the 8th place. Greg having a good run here today in the DK Ulrich car.
And Morgan Shepherd's car that we were talking about with Wood Brothers is in 9th, Ned, and Ken Schrader looks good out there in 10th.
Well, it's a Ford Chevrolet battle again. Irvin's car is a Ford and Marlin's car is a Chevrolet, and they're bumper to bumper here in this 500.
Well, Ernie Irvin knows how strong that 4 car is because he drove it for several years. He won here with it, and he wonders how much does he really have left. Irvin passed him a little bit ago, so he knows that he can pass him, but does he know whether he can't pass him back or not?
Mm-hmm. Around Gant, remember we mentioned Gant falling out. He was in one of those early incidents, got the car all crashed. This is his last 500.
Anderson Harry's going to hang it up after this season. Sorry to see him go. Great, just hard charger, all those short tracks. Told me this winter one time that he'd knocked his teeth out three times. I said, you had? He said, yeah, one time it was at one of your tracks. I've sure forgotten that, I think on purpose. But actually got some help. Butch Lindley, I think, had parked him that night. They'd had a great war.
Well, he's been a great spinner.
Oh, hasn't he, though? And the point was that he's been all over the country running every little quarter mile and third mile. And in those days, he'd run five nights a week. He and Morgan Shepherd and Butch and the old Iron Man, Jack Ingram, all over the eastern seaboard and sometimes out into the Midwest.
Nine cars in this lead draft. Here goes Jeff Gordon up on the outside of Dale Earnhardt, trying to take over the fourth position.
Getting help from Lake Speed and Mark Martin there.
But here comes Greg Sachs. He's going to run down there behind Earnhardt, try to push him on up in there. Let's see how this works out. Speed goes high. Mark Martin will float up there with him. Gordon's going to have the position.
Sachs is another driver out of Long Island, New York, that likes to go fast in this racetrack. Remember, he won out here in the 400, 4th of July, which is the next time they get together here at Daytona. Impressive showing by Lake Speed for Bud Moore today. And now Greg Sachs looked to me like he was going to run right over the top of those cars, and he got it down to the inside. He's flying.
He had a tremendous run. Yes.
19 cars remain in the lead lap. A couple more laps and we'll be at 170. 425.
Morgan Shepherd with a run on Mark Martin going into turn three, trying to take over the eighth position.
Let's not forget the car back there in the 13th position behind all of this. The car that everybody in speaking about right now throughout that packed grandstand, that one right there. That's the one that if anybody can make it without another fuel stop from 13th, Bill Elliott. Think he can do it?
Yeah, if anybody can, he can. I think he can. I don't think there's any question about he'll go the distance.
Here he is. There's a nice man. Just doesn't get bothered out here, frustrated, just gets the job done. And he's waiting out his time.
Didn't have a good year in 1993.
Didn't win.
Came on strong towards the end of the year. We're back with Ernie Irvin now, leading this race.
Sterling Marlin still second. Labonte third. Jeff Gordon fourth. Earnhardt in fifth.
There you can see that glare as they go through the trioval here and into turn one. It does affect them some going through there. Their eyes get adjusted to it to a degree, though, and that makes it so they can go. We'll be back with more of the Daytona 500.
Daytona, Ernie Irvin stays in front. Back in 1975, he ran his first races out in Stockton, California. And by 78, he was on his way to being a champion. Will he be the second time 500 winner after today in this great American race? There he is, leading at the moment in the Robert Gates car.
Who would think that gasoline mileage can determine the winner now? It's going to be close.
He won the first 125-miler on Thursday. Of years back, he was fifth in the Winston Cup standings for the entire season, all 30 races. Reminder, the Winston Cup moves on. Quest for it. Rockingham a week away, and then Richmond, Virginia on the three-quarter mile. Sawyers up there really created a great facility for the state of Virginia. Here is Ernie Irvin over Earnhardt by what, a car length, net, maybe two?
Not much. It changes each lap. Sterling Marlin, of course, running in the second position.
And watch that blue number 15, and he's taking the high ride now in the corners. Lake Speed is using up all the banking in this car number 15.
That car just simply feels more comfortable for him up there as we ride with him through this turn. See, he goes into the turn very low, Now he's staying low on this turn.
Yeah, he's down there this time.
And higher through turns one and two.
Well, let's check him out one, two, because the last two or three times to one and two, he's been all the way out there where Earnhardt was earlier in the race. As we watch, let's go to Mike Joy.
Here's the handling and horsepower duo for Ernie Irvin. Handling first. Larry McReynolds, if he's getting loose, is it the car or is it the traffic that's making him loose?
Well, right now we seem to have finally gotten it pretty good. You know, kept adjusting, and I think we're in pretty good shape, you know. We got 25 laps to go. There's a long string of cars back there. You don't know what they're doing, if they're just sitting there riding or what's going on.
Now the horsepower side, Robert Yates, are you concerned about gas mileage with him in front of that pack?
Well, certainly we probably are using more fuel, but, you know, we're just hoping everything else stays together. I think we'll be okay on fuel.
That's from the leader's pit. Now David Hott.
Gary D. Hott, we feel that, we hear that some of the cars are still pretty loose out there. How's Terry Labonte's car?
Actually, right now, David, it's just a tick tight. We did a few things to free it up a little bit. I think the biggest question is going to be the fuel mileage if it goes green. We got to figure where we can just barely go it.
I was going to say, if the car's tight on green, is that going to make your fuel consumption just a bit worse? With the car being tight, will that make the fuel consumption worse?
Probably will. We're trying to conserve fuel right now a little bit.
A good run, and it's a real cliffhanger.
Terry's doing a real good
19
job.
Cars on that lead lap, the all-time record 18. 1993.
And eight cars in the lead draft. Greg Sachs has fallen out of that. You see the white car back there behind. He has lost the draft of the leaders.
Eight cars came by in 1.2 seconds. But Ernie Irvan, who came out here from California a few years ago, worked as a welder at the Charlotte Speedway, welding the seats in the expansion program there. And his first benefactor of all people was Dale Earnhardt, who helps him get going. And now here, this is the race Earnhardt won so badly to win, and it's being paced now by the man he helped, Ernie Irvan.
We watched Irvan drive his first Winston Cup race in 1987 in Richmond, Virginia. That first win came in 1990 at Bristol, Tennessee. This is the one. This is the one they want to win. All right, 25 laps to go. What's in your mind right now if you're leading out here, Ned?
Well, first of all, as Larry McReynolds pointed out there a moment ago, you're wondering what does anyone else have back there. They're just sitting there riding, and that's what they're doing. They're just sitting there in a line, no one making an attempt to pass anyone else, because if they do to pull out to pass, that is going to use extra fuel. They aren't about to show their hand. It's not time to do that yet. When you get down the last 10 laps, that's when you start jockeying around. So, he's wondering how much do they have left and who will make it as far as fuel is concerned.
Ned, I'm told that you guys in the last 10 laps, that every noise a car makes sounds twice as loud and twice as worrisome.
Well, those noises will appear sometime, and especially if you got a pretty good lead, that's when they appear more. But when you got someone right on your bumper, many times you don't have time to think about or hear those kind of things.
Second place, Sterling Marlin.
This Daytona 500 race summary is sponsored by Texaco Haviland. Add more life to your car.
Taking a look at the race summary. After 450 miles, 13 different drivers have been leaders in the event, and they've swapped it 33 times, and the speed is way down to just 153 miles an hour. Four cautions, 22 laps, two major incidents, eight cars eliminated from the 42-car starting field. And there you see the attrition on the day, the latest, Dale Jarrett officially outside the car. Now, a moment ago, we were watching and we were riding with Ernie Irvan. Listen and watch to what happens.
Boy, he is really fighting that steering wheel, Ken. He dropped back from the lead back to the seventh position. I thought he had a flat tire there, but he's still staying out there running. But he is really fighting as if he was on a half a mile track.
Well, we're trying to get more word on what the story is with Ernie Irvan as that car backed up. And here's Mike.
Ken, he told the crew the car just got real loose on him in turn four, and he decided just to get out of there and let him go so the next caution wouldn't be him. So he voluntarily got out of there when the car loosened up. As to why Dale Earnhardt is doing a very un-Earnhardt-like riding around in the pit, they are so close on gas. They know they can make lap 199. They don't think they can make 200 with this fuel load.
But as we understand it, Mike, he has been advised to go. The word is for him to stay out there. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah, they're going to go for it, Ken. That's their best chance to win this race. If you stop now under green, you lose. It's the only chance they have unless the caution flag changes everything.
Now, Ned, the Urban car came in where? About 145, something like that. So they really got to stretch it.
Yeah, they really do.
137 miles.
Yep, that's a long way. Yeah. But, you know, they easily make the 125-mile qualifying races without a pit stop. And Bill Elliott did make 61 laps earlier here today.
A lot of anxious people got their pencils out on pit row trying to figure this one. Right down, as they used to say in the coffee ad, good to the last drop. And they hope it doesn't drop before they're out of turn four.
Talk about dropping. Ernie Irvin just dropped under Morgan Shepherd. Dale Earnhardt did too and just blew him right off.
Standings have Sterling Marlin staying first. Terry Labonte second. Jeff Gordon is third. Mark Martin is fourth. Ernie Irvin is fifth. Earnhardt is in sixth. And there you see Sterling Marlin continuing to lead in car number four.
He and Terry Labonte have gotten themselves a little bit of a lead over the third place car of Jeff Gordon, who has Mark Martin right on his bumper.
Sterling Marlin stepped into the Morgan McClure team after Ernie Irvin left to join Robert Yates last year. Certainly this is one of his best rides. Martin, Marlin out in front, and Gordon, who is riding still in third, trying to win this for their first career win. Make it Daytona. Join some pretty illustrious folks up there if they do that. Tiny Lund in 63. Mario Andretti in 67. Pete Hamilton, for those great days in 1970 with that Plymouth, Talladega, and here. Derek Cope in 1990. Very good company. And look at Terry Labonte. He has to be thrilled for all the misfortune he's had here, Chris. What a great day.
He's measuring Mr. Marlin to see, you know, where the best place to go, and it's time to make the drive.
16th start for Terry Labonte. Wife Kim looking on here today. He's come close. 84. Had a good run going. Wound up 12th. 86 he came back. Got a second. 1990 he was a runner-up in this event.
Now Urban has caught Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon, and he's going to move around to Mark Martin, trying to take over the fourth position, and does.
And this lead draft does not have Earnhardt in it.
No, he has dropped back pretty good, currently being shown in the seventh position. Make that eighth position.
We're trying to get an update for you on the condition of that Earnhardt number three. Is it a miss or is it like yesterday? When it looked like he was down and out, not a chance, no way he could win it. Then, five laps to go, came from fifth and just kept motoring. And then that last dramatic lap, inside blocked, outside blocked as he and Labonte fought. Went back to the inside, back to the outside, and then going into four. The minute Labonte committed to the outside, Earnhardt had him. It was an incredible finish.
Well, now the five cars, their leaders are bunched up with each other. Ernie Irvin behind Jeff Gordon.
Third and fourth. You're looking from the third back to the fourth.
And was that Mark Martin moving around Irvin once again? Martin taking over the fourth position.
Well, Ned, you're a driver. What is the time to go here?
If you have something left, it's not quite time. I think you got
to
get down.
12 laps to go.
But you don't dare go.
You got to get down a little
bit. You don't dare go. With the fuel situation the way it is, if you go, you could be gone out of this place.
When do you go?
I think you wait till you get down the last five laps.
The one thing you don't want to hear is that thing burp right now.
Earnhardt is 2 4/10 seconds behind the leaders. And I don't think this is by design. I don't think he means to be that far behind.
There you see them coming through the tri-oval, and that gives you the interval from Sterling Marlin back to the black number three.
He lost another tenth of a second that lap around. He's 2.5 seconds behind now.
Well, he's got to get cracking if he's going to come. Long way for him to get back into this. He wants this race so badly, and it keeps eluding him. Those final laps of this 500. Nightmares for Dale Earnhardt. 85 engine failure. That was a little early before it went out. Several laps ago, Earnhardt forced high up on the track. Something may have happened there. Let's go back and take another look here. Let's take another look right here, Ned.
Well, we see him down on the end. Oh, he's up very high as Jeff Gordon goes under him. And Dave Marcus there behind him. Mark Martin goes by, and Morgan Shepherd will come by as well. So he got, nobody didn't hit him and knock him up there, but maybe the air off of their car just pushed him up there a little bit.
1 year ago, he led at the white flag, then was passed by Dale Jarrett in that dramatic finish.
But right now, Earnhardt's being passed by Greg Sachs for the ninth position.
Mark Martin making his move there in the front, trying to get by Jeff Gordon.
Now, it's time now, Chris, for those in third, fourth, and fifth to start positioning themselves. Yeah, they need to. Ernie Irvin might be just trying to do that. No, he looked. Couldn't do anything.
Well, Martin scooted right down there. Thank you.
Exactly. He may be a fellow Ford driver, but you're not going by me.
That's right. You got three Chevrolets out front, a pair of Fords next. Yeah. There goes Martin now around Jeff Gordon, and here comes Ernie Irvin down on the inside as well. So, yep, time to make those moves.
For fourth. Into the last 10 laps of the Daytona 500. And Sterling Marlin draws away. Does he have enough fuel to go these last 9 laps? Call it 8, I believe, this time by.
He would love to see those guys start racing side by side back there and let him open up a little bit of a cushion and then just pray for having enough gas. You know, they don't have gas gauges in those cars. They go by fuel pressure. Let's go to the pits and Mike Joy.
Richard Childress a minute ago was hopping mad when Dale Earnhardt got carried way up the racetrack, but he says it doesn't matter now. He's back in that second pack, and Dale says the car's not working for him.
Now, something happened over there when him and a couple of cars, we don't know if they got together or what happened. He come on the radio and said something. From that time on, the car's just been so loose he couldn't drive.
This has been the toughest week for you guys. How much does this hurt to not now be in a position to win this race?
It's just one of those bad deals right now. Just have to go on.
Remember 1990, Chris, the leader, they took the white flag, he cut a tire on the backstretch, came home fifth. Jeff won't come his way. But for Sterling Marlin, 7 to go for Terry Labonte, 86 and 90, second place in this race.
Well, a moment ago, we had 3 Chevrolets up front and 2 Fords. Now we have 2 of each up there. Those 4 pull away a little bit from Jeff Gordon. In fact, Jeff Gordon about to lose the fifth place to Lake Speed.
A lot of folks in Tennessee not using up much of the seat in the living room today, right on the edge, as Sterling Marlin stays first. Terry Labonte, the Texas great, stays right there in second. Hooks up in third. Mark Martin, you want to go fast, you got to be so careful on the fuel, you've got to get it home.
The interval's tightening up on these cars. They're getting closer and closer. The third and fourth place cars right behind Terry Labonte.
Oh, we may see some of them die at any moment here. They've got to be running low on fuel. Here's Jeff Gordon. And you're riding with Lake Speed just behind him in sixth. Jeff Gordon is in fifth. Waiting out for New Year's Eve. Who is the ball going to drop on?
There's Ernie Irvin. Backed off a little bit when his car got loose there a moment ago and let those tires cool just a little bit. Now brought her back up to third.
Sun is to kill you as you come down this main straightaway. 5 to go.
Got ahead of Martin.
Mark Martin back there in fourth trying to manipulate Sun.
Yeah, he needs to start making a move here shortly. However, he and Irvin could possibly team up together and go by that pair of Chevrolets.
Terry Labonte looking good, and he's right there. He hasn't missed a step. Stays in line, scoops in some clean air once in a while, and ducks right back in there.
Well, yesterday in the Goodish 300, Terry was leading the race there at the end of the race. Thought he was in good shape, and all of a sudden he wound up fourth. And so he's not about to try to make a pass now. He'll wait till the last lap, I believe, unless somebody does something to make him do something different than what he wants to do.
Four drivers pulling away with four laps to go. Three of them seeking their first 500 win. One, the 91 champion, trying to repeat back there in the black number 28, Ernie Irvin, native of Modesto, California. On board with Ernie as he scoots up to the outside.
But that doesn't work.
No place to go there.
He might have been just testing him a little bit. Sterling moving down to pick up the draft of a car he's coming up to lap.
And all they're saying on the radio is a lap count from those drivers and to those drivers. Yes. No other information.
It's up to them now. It's up to the driver. It's in his hands totally. Okay, here's a move. Irvin on the inside of Terry Labonte as he came by that lap car.
Jimmy Hensley.
Pulling one.
Mark Martin up into third.
Hensley running 15th. And Terry Labonte has gone from second to a battle for fourth.
But he's, yeah, now they're running side by side, so it gets down to a two-way slugfest. Lake Speed is out of fuel.
He's in the pits.
Lake Speed, who was running in the sixth position, out of fuel.
And he can't get the car fired in the pits as we watch this battle for the lead.
And that's a Ford.
Chevy Ford confrontation. Whoop. Did you hear that thing lean out, or were we just going away?
Two laps to go. 5 miles, a little less than five.
Here's Jeff Gordon, back in fifth. Morgan Shepherd in sixth. Morgan way up on the banking. Story is right here. The 500 to be decided. Will it be a new winner? In the 36th running of this race, Sterling Marlin.
Terry Labonte has lost the draft of Mark Martin. I don't think he has much of a chance. Martin has probably lost the draft of these two cars. Looks like it might be one of these or another car going slowly down the backstretch has run out of fuel as well. And it's Mark Martin.
We have Martin's out
Mark
of fuel.
Martin out of run fuel. Out of fuel.
The Fords are not getting the mileage the Chevrolets are getting.
But one is.
White flag.
Robert Yates, number 28, is still there. Last lap to decide it all. Sterling Marlin stays first. Ernie Irvin in second. Back straightaway final time.
It's between these two cars. Has Troy Aikman broke Sterling some luck?
We'll see.
Can Ernie Irvin pass him on this last lap, last turn?
Into turn three. Sterling Marlin in front. Ernie Irvin closing ground. Here they come down the stretch for the final time. It is Sterling Marlin in the lead. Down to the inside comes the 28. Coming to the line. Sterling Marlin's going to win it. Ernie Irvin, who left the Morgan McClure ride to go with the 28 team of Robert Yates, is defeated by that team, and Sterling Marlin wins his first Winston Cup victory in the greatest race of them all.
Back with you at Daytona. Every team is coming out to congratulate Sterling Marlin as we look at the unofficial results. They're lined up along pit road, and each team is coming out to shake his hand. Sterling Marlin, after a brilliant day here in the 500, wins it his 279th effort. And team after team coming out from all along pit road. Now he's with his own team to say congratulations for a job well done to a young man who at 10 years of age can still remember working on his dad's race car in a tin shop with a gas heater on a farm up there in Columbia, Tennessee. Gee, remember a couple of years ago, 1991, Ernie Irvin won it. Sterling Marlin was second. Today, it's all his, and deservedly so.
Ran a great race.
Second-generation drivers done it for second year in a row, Ned. Hey.
Third year in a row. Yeah. Yep. It was Davey Allison, and then
That's
Dale
right.
Jarrett,
yep.
Now Sterling Marlin.
Mm-hmm.
And they push it into Victor Lane. Wonder if he's out of gas. He might not have enough gas to carry it in there.
Remember the Peanuts character? I remember Sterling once saying that that Charlie Brown kicking the football, and Lucy was always taking it away from him. Today he kicked the football. Ladies and gentlemen, in victory lane at the Daytona Speedway from Columbia, Tennessee, former Nashville Speedway track champion Sterling Marlin about to clamber out of car number four, and Mike Joy is waiting there with him.
Second to Ernie Irvin in this race in 1991, second in the last two Pepsi 400s. And Sterling, he's more surrounded here than he was on the track. Here he comes. In 1992 at Talladega after the 500, I had to speak to you after finishing second for the eighth time in your career, and we agreed someday your day would come, and today it is.
Well, I knew if I ever got with a, you know, good race team, and I tell you, these boys worked awful hard all winter, and we come down here to win it, and I knew when I left house we was going to win a race, and it wasn't looking too good early, but they done a heck of a job getting the car adjusted, and man, I love them. Thank Cole Remy, everybody. I love them.
Can you believe you're here?
No, not really. I'm at peace myself.
Congratulations. Thanks. Here's Ken Squire.
The fifth driver to score his first career win in the Daytona 500. It's Sterling Marlin defeating Ernie Irvin. Dramatic finish. Terry Labonte comes home third. Jeff Gordon gets fourth, one position up from a year ago. How about Greg Saxon, sixth? Earnhardt having to settle for seventh place today. Ken Schrader rounding out the top 10 in the 500 this afternoon here at the Daytona International Speedway. For Chris Economaki, Ned Jarrett, David Hobbs, and Mike Joy, I'm Ken Squire saying so long from the Daytona International Speedway for today's 500 winner. Is Tennessee's Sterling Marlin. Annual Daytona 500 has been a presentation of CBS Sports. In loving memory to our late colleagues Jack Foster and Neil Bunn.